Hey guys, welcome back. It's episode 17 of Rapid Fire Free for All. And we got a great show lined up for you tonight, guys. Our subject is transhumanism, and we got a special guest here from the YouTubes. It's Nicholson, 1968. Welcome. How you doing, buddy?
Doing good. Thanks for having me.
Hey, very, very, very welcome, and it's our pleasure. And we got some familiar faces here. Rick, want to introduce our panel?
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show on transhumanism. This is going to be a pretty crazy show tonight. We've got Ladder Rain here with us.
And we got,
and there's Professor Doom.
Hey.
And Chad Lilly.
Bonjour.
Excellent. So, yeah, man, if you don't have the EBGBs by the end of this show, something's wrong with you, because we're going to be talking about a lot of creepy stuff and tying together a lot of plot points in the grand scheme of things. And, well, I'd like to start off, because we've got a lot to talk about tonight, so we'll just get going right away here. Nicholson, would you like to introduce yourself and what you came across to lead you down this path?
Yes, I go by the YouTube handle Nicholson1968. That's my website as well, Nicholson1968.com. Started on a journey probably about 15 years ago. Did not know it was going to lead me to where I am today, but just was looking for truth and just kind of questioning, you know, what's going on in the universe, those kind of things. But you know, I stumble upon some studying of the elites and the things that are the people who are ruling this world. It's kind of where my thing began, and the whole 9/11, waking up of 9/11, that it was a deception, and just kind of got started that way. And I figured if 9/11, we were lied to about 9/11, then what else have we been lied to about? And also, what started my YouTube channel too was 9/11 was known about in advance in the movies, in the music, in the media. So the next event that the elite are trying to pull off or things, that information would be encoded also in music, you know, movies, the media. So I just kind of try to decode things, and because they have their own little hidden language kind of thing. And that's kind of where I kind of got my start. But then here lately, just stumbling on programmable matter, DNA, the triple helix, nanotechnology, AI, Morgellons disease, which is a mysterious disease you can hardly find information on, but it's real, and connecting the dots, because if you look at things separately, you really won't figure it out, but when you start connecting the dots, that's when the bigger picture comes together. Not only with that, but a lot of other things in the world. So that's kind of what I do.
That's like the mother load of like all rabbit holes. Eh?
Yeah. And then I stumbled on transhumanism, you know, that which I'm invited here tonight to on the panel. So I appreciate it for having me. Thank you.
Hey, not a problem, man. We needed somebody. And you've been doing this since long before any other of the YouTubers kind of jumped onto the subject that you... It's a crazy story how you kind of got into it in the first place, and I found it rather interesting. It was,
People thought I was crazy, at first. You know, when you start speaking of downloading your consciousness into another vessel and things like that, way back in 1999 when I was posting, when I wasn't even making videos yet, I was actually posting on my little blog spot.
Yeah.
Yes, it was. And my family, you know, disowned me for a while, and you know, things I was being shown and that I couldn't even understand at the time. So now I have a lot of people that come back to me, and I have about 85,000 people. A lot of people don't know this, but I have about 85,000 plus followers on my website, and from Germany, Holland, you name it.
Right on.
And they come back and they go, you know, I watched your video about 3 years ago, and now I come back and I watch it now, and they're like, it makes a little more sense. And that's what I've always said, is to get from A to D, you have to understand B and C, because you just, so what I'm saying is there's people out there tonight, if you've never heard of transhumanism, then you might not get some of the stuff. You may think it's science fiction, but you have to understand B and C. You have to do some homework, some, you know, some studying, some research. So, you know, if I sit down with somebody and say, let me tell you about transhumanism, they're going to go, what? You know, they don't even know what I'm talking about. So,
I was going to say, by the end of the night, like, what we're going to basically show the listeners is that what seems like science fiction here is actually a collection of several and many, plausible things. Like, there's several things that might sound like outlandish, but you know what? They fit.
Hey, everybody.
What the heck?
They sound a lot less science fiction-esque today than when I heard them 10 years ago. Yeah. People of the likes of, say, Ray Kurzweil and others who were speaking about these things way back then, even to me, it sounded like science fiction. Like, well, I thought, yeah, maybe one day, you know, in 100 years or something, maybe. But now we've had such amazing turn of events and so many new things just thrown upon us that I'm beginning to see that this transhumanism agenda is in full swing. And some of the things that I first heard about that made me think along the lines of science fiction have already come to pass, making these things quite possible.
Yeah. Well, you know what? A lot of these things, all the way from microbiology and testing, using other disease and other patented diseases, releasing them into the populations, monitoring their growth either in a social system or their actual biological growth, right? They, you know, these things have all been kind of interconnected for certain specific reasons. And, well, we're going to explore a lot of that tonight. There are so many topics that we could start on pretty much any one. What do you think is probably the most important thing to kind of start this path there, Nicholson?
I tell you the most important part to understanding transhumanism, and people might not like it, might not agree with it. I didn't go down this path, but after doing years and years of research, if you do not approach this from the spiritual side of things, you're not going to understand what your enemy is after and what is being perpetrated on humanity. Because to me, this is not a Christian, Catholic, Muslim, black, white thing. This is what we're battling is way, way deeper than people understand. It's against humanity. That's where you got to start, is a spiritual connection to what is being perpetrated.
And Danny here, he's got a lot of research that he's done on some of the bloodlines and some of the ancient stuff that's been kind of spread around throughout different cultures as well, because it's kind of peppered everywhere, isn't it, Doom?
You know, you mentioned something, Robert, offline.
Oh, sorry, I turned my mic off. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, I was going to say this real quick that I don't want Robert. I don't want you to forget. You said something very important, when we can bring it up whenever, but people have to understand, they think this technology that's coming is just all new, but in reality, from all of my research and everything, this technology once existed, and it was destroyed for a purpose. And we'll go wherever you want to go with that. I just wanted you to put that on a notepad and bring that back up, and people need to understand that.
Gotcha.
Yeah, and that is actually going to be very, very important. Yeah, Doom, I don't know, you might want to tell the listeners a few bits about how this might be like related to ancient blood war, like blood feuds between the different lines. And
well,
I know Nicholson's done some work on that as well, but go ahead, sorry.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say that their plans for transhumanism has much to do with these royal bloodlines, or even just the certain bloodlines. Period. I mean, you look at let's say the European nobles, royalties, all that good stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And they're kind of into this interbreeding or intermarrying type thing. But interestingly enough, when you go to look at like the Babylonian Sumerian tablets, that's exactly what the writers of the tablets, being Sumerian or Babylonian, said about their own anthropomorphic deities. Shamash, Nanarsin, whatever the case may be, they were all doing the exact same thing the gods were, or the alienistic gods, if you want to believe that aspect of it. And, yeah, they were intermarrying, sisters, half-sisters, first cousins, all that good stuff. Very interesting that the royal bloodline seemed to follow suit and do the exact same thing, right? It had to do with something about keeping the blood the exact same. Rh negative, perhaps?
Could be. Interesting. And it's the only one that's only replaceable by Rh negative blood, too. Like, it doesn't trace to any other known origin.
Well, it's the
bloodline itself, I mean.
Yeah, it is the least of the least of the blood types of, you know, in the planet. There's only 15% of the planet is Rh negative.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And out of that 15%, there are certain areas like the Basque of Spain. They are one of the biggest population of Rh negative there are.
Right. Huh. Well, we're going to come back to that for sure, because that's definitely an important thing. Because if we look at the who's behind all of this, there's a lot of Luciferian reference here to who's really behind the transhuman agenda. And the reason why I want to bring in old family lines is because some of these lines may be responsible for keeping hidden or destroying the ancient knowledge, like the ancient technologies that might be being brought back. Do you want to talk about the Luciferian connection, Nicholson?
Sure. I mean, you know, the whole thing with transhumanism, you know, what is transhumanism? It's trying to make a man a better man. That's all it is. And let me start by saying this. If someone has a limb missing and they replace it with a medical limb or, you know, another metal, that's not what I'm talking about. You know, if you have a pacemaker, that's not what I'm talking about. What my side is about, when man chooses to take technology too far, basically it's going to be a repeat of the garden. The enemy was whispering in the garden and said, hey, don't want you to reach out for this knowledge of good and evil, because God don't want you to partake of it, because you surely won't die. Okay? That was the first lie that started this mess that we're in. And that's what's going to happen again, and what is happening now is transhumanism, this technology, the elite are going to try to use this technology to try to live forever another way with this technology. But they're also going to use the transhuman agenda to control the rest of the people.
Exactly.
That's the whole key.
A ruler wants their people, their subjects, to love them.
Yeah.
So they're going to try to turn us into people that love them and are eager to do their bidding.
Yeah.
Well, there we go. We got a double up, huh? Good show. It's not always been that way. rule by fear. You know what I mean? It's like some of these rulers in the past have believed that it was better to rule in fear than to have your subjects love you. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So I guess here it is in a nutshell for me is, and I'm coming from the Christian perspective. And I studied the Quran, I studied New Age, Buddhism, you name it, is what is going on is, if you don't know where the temple of God is, and you don't know what it is, most people on the face of the earth think the temple of God is sitting in Israel somewhere waiting to be built. That's what they believe. They're waiting for an Antichrist person to walk into a physical temple, put something in it that is an abomination that causes desolation, where God can't dwell in that temple anymore, and then it's on. And that's when everything's going to come to pass. That's what the majority of people believe. But the truth of it is, we are the temple of God. He dwells in us, in our blood, whatever you want to say, our essence, spirit, consciousness, whatever you want to call that, okay? And the enemy is trying to circumvent that, trying to rewire the temple of God where he's no longer in that temple. That's all it is. Think about it. God dwells not in a physical temple made of hands, so the enemy cannot create anything. So he wants to create his own temples. This is the illusion of transhumanism. It's a good thing. Don't you want to upgrade yourself? Don't you want to be able to know a million things in a second or so? That's the illusion. And here's the thing is, we're not meant, this is my analogy, people who follow me, the caterpillar who is ugly will become a butterfly whether they know it or not, whether it knows it or not. If you just let it run its course, the man will become what it's supposed to become if you leave it alone. But if you try to make a man a better man, a transhuman, you're monkeying with creation and you're jacking it up. That, you see where that is? That's the illusion that is being forced in the future right now in the pre-programming of movies like Chappie, Selfless, Advantageous. There's movies coming out now talking about moving your consciousness into a younger vessel so you'll look better. You'll have the technology mixed in. That's why the last prophecy in Christianity is a kingdom of iron and clay. Iron being tech, clay being flesh.
Yeah.
And you know, so it's a big agenda.
Yeah, and like, I mean, predictive programming wise, I mean, Chappie, just what it represented scared the crap out of me. Like especially the ending I didn't see coming. Spoiler alert, cover your ears if you don't want to know what happens. But yeah, one of the main characters, they save his life by uploading his consciousness into a robot body. And it's like, huh. Didn't see that one coming. I thought it was gonna be that whole Pinocchio analogy, right? Like trying to become human. But it was the other way around, and that's what kind of freaked me the hell out.
And there's a real sinister pre-programming part in that movie. Mm-hmm. And look at it again, Robert. Watch this. Chappie is mad. The person who built him, he refers to him as his maker.
Yes.
Chappie says to his maker, he said, "Maker, why did you make me just to die?" Okay? You see the pre-programming?
Yep.
That's what is being done now. Why did God create me just to die? But the truth of the matter is, we're not going to die. It's part of the evolution. You come as a man, and you die as a man. You follow Jesus Christ. What did he do? He came to show you the way how to do this, to overcome death. He fixed the problem of whatever Adam and Eve messed up. But that movie is telling you, he's mad at his maker because you just built me to last for so long and then I'm going to die. How dare you?
Yeah.
That is in the minds of people who are going to watch that movie. And if they don't know the truth of what I'm telling you is, it's okay. You come here. The caterpillar is not going to die. It just goes in the sleep state cocoon. Then you're born again. Then you get your wings and you become what you're supposed to become. It's part of, it's like this. I ask people, is a caterpillar and a butterfly two things or one thing? And a lot of people say it's two different things. No, it's one thing, but it's at two different stages of its development. And that's what man is. We're just in this stage of development. The next stage is the next stage, and that's the way it's supposed to be. There's nothing broken here.
So these creeps are basically, they're trying to cheat the system. They want, they want to have their cake and eat it too by artificial or synthetic means.
Exactly. And here's what's funny. You can use scripture. They are the builders that rejected the true cornerstone. They are the builders, the Freemasons, Illuminati, New World, they're all the same. See, that's the real secret of Freemason or Mason. On the outside, which everybody sees, a Mason is a builder of a physical builder. But when you get up, you know, you asked me earlier on about Luciferian. When you get up into the 30 through the 33 degrees of Freemason, you learn the light is Lucifer, and also they're building a temple, not a physical temple, not a, you see what I'm saying? They're building something else over time. The illusion is Freemasons do good work in the community, and they do buildings, a masonry, but in the inner secrets of Freemason, the temple that they are building is what I'm speaking of, a transhuman temple, an AI temple. They're trying to cheat the system because they don't want to die in answer to Christ. They're you see what I'm saying? They want to stay here in a physical body, a transhuman body. They want to try to cheat that system.
Mm-hmm. Now, where do we go from there? Because there's a lot of different directions, eh?
Yeah.
So, okay. So, basically...
we're screwed.
Yeah, well, yeah. Well, we got Lucifer here trying to make a comeback and, quite frankly, cheat the system. And that's what we're like, you were talking about the Tower of Babylon. That came up in our conversation off the air as well. And I guess trying to touch God is the key theme here, right? But by artificial means.
Yeah, trying to become human gods. And that's, you know, you just don't go down that road. And see, that's what people need to understand. You know, don't be scared. I mean, you know, Satan is lying to the elites more than anybody. They're so arrogant, they think they have it figured out. And I have to share this with people. See, the elites are taught, the secret societies, Skull and Bones, all of them, see, they believe that man, this is the key to why they do the dumb stuff they do. They believe man was held captive in the Garden of Eden. And it was not until Lucifer, Satan, the serpent showed up, shared the knowledge with man, that freed them from the bondage of the Creator. And that one day, through man's intellect, he will become gods. That's what they believe. That's what they're taught. That's why they do what they do.
That makes sense. Yeah. That they would say that. In a sense, it's a twisting of the truth.
Yeah, definitely. Well, Satan's a scripture lawyer, so anything they do is pretty much twisting everything that's good into bad.
That's right. Because, in fact, they weren't prisoners in the garden. The garden included the whole earth, really, because it says God gave him dominion over the whole earth. So, but they lived in that garden. And the fruit that they ate, that they were tempted to eat, was the knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So where they only knew supposedly good up to that point, they became aware of evil, and they were, because to have free choice, you have to have a choice. You have to have another thing to pick, right?
Hey, I didn't give Spiro a proper panel welcome there. And he got kicked. I thought he left because he was upset, but no, he's back. Hey, Spiro, how you doing, buddy? Oh, yeah.
His mic's off.
I don't think he'd get upset.
No, I'm just playing. Yeah, when his mic's working, we'll have him cut in and say hey. Sorry, go ahead, Rick.
So by making that choice to embrace the knowledge of evil, we needed to find a way to rise to what we had before, and since being separated from God, by the evil that we now have. Uh-huh. We were disconnected from God, and the only way to become what we were created to be would be to do it ourselves.
Exactly. I'd like to welcome Dabu. We lost Spiro and got a Dabu. How you doing, bud?
How you guys doing?
Very well, thank you.
Yeah. Hey, Dabu.
Yeah, we got a hell of a night going here, man.
Yeah, I've been listening in. I decided to try to join here. I don't have the best connection, but yeah, good conversation.
Thank you, thank you. I wanted to switch gears over to some of the technology. I mean, we can dwell deeper into where the agenda is pointing. I just wanted to introduce some of the characters here, because as this kind of goes on, you start seeing the relationships between the world events that are taking place. Like, everything is being pushed in a direction. Most of it's ramping up at a faster pace. It's as if it's not working out like quite like they planned or something, but that's a good thing. Look at the tech. The whole Morgellons thing. You've been doing some research now on that, Nicholson.
Yeah, I have. I just kind of got into it from the back door sense, because I was looking into movies, and people who follow my channel, I watch the movies, music videos, the media, because. Right.
Looking for symbology and things along those lines.
And 9/11 was known about way in advance, so you can see it in the movies, music, the media. So what I do is look for things. So the next event or next, you have to learn, I don't want to, but learn their language, so to speak. And deal in symbols, they deal in backwards, occult stuff like that. But, here lately, in the last 2 or 3 years, the movies with the programmable matter, the goo, whatever you want to call it, the Helix, the TV show with the virus, and yep. I mean, there's so much into that.
And that's a Ronald Moore production, and so far, everything I've seen Ronald Moore create has had a lot of transhumanistic things, especially with the Cylons from Battlestar.
Yeah.
They would upload their consciousness to new bodies upon death, which is kind of crazy. And the weird thing was, is the humans were the polytheists in that, and then the robots themselves, the Cylons, they were the monotheists. They believed in the one true God, which is like a total reverse program. Like, it's a reverse programming scheme, I thought.
Right. And here's my analogy of everything, of things we've discussed, is if you take bread and then you take a jar of jelly, then you take a jar of peanut butter, and they're all separate. You put them together, then you have a sandwich. This is what's going on. If I mention cloning, if I mention AI, I mention 3D printing, I mention programmable matter, all separate, different things. Put it together, you've got a recipe for an engineered person. I mean, really, DNA... it's kind of scary, and a lot of people think that's science fiction, but the technology is out there. Microsoft has a programmable matter division. Look it up. It's there.
Yeah, that's almost as scary as that product where they mix the peanut butter and the jelly and put it in the same jar.
Yeah, it's about as much as
bad jelly and bad peanut butter, too.
So the Morgellons thing, with the, people who didn't believe in chemtrails at all 5 years ago, now look, it's coming more to light, and, what is actually, chemtrails being used for, the metal in there, and that's the other thing, humans are not meant for man-made metal, metal in your vaccine, metal in the GMOs, metal in your prescription drugs. You start putting some of this stuff together, they're trying to condition humanity to accept more iron, more metal for what's to come. That's why the last kingdom in prophecy is a mix of iron and clay. It doesn't cleave together. That whole spiritual side of things. So,
Well, you know, this is where it kind of gets a little bit creepy, because before we get into the what is Morgellons, which we should probably get into first, we want to acknowledge the fact, though, that these chemtrails do have recorded amounts of barium, strontium, aluminum, sulfides, and oxides, and there's a veritable shit ton of them. And they're in everything you eat. They're in everything that you're breathing it in constantly. And it sits and settles on stuff, like everything that you use. So, like, you do have a higher level of these active, like, some are active in some cases, and they're heavy metals. And leading into that, with this Morgellons thing, it's this is where it starts to get science fiction-y, eh?
It does, big time. A lot of people... You know, they're trying to push that people that have it are hallucinating, you know, that it doesn't really exist and all of that. But, you know, doing my research, you know, I don't know, I'm not an authority on Morgellons, but, you know, it's real, it's out there. I don't know if it's a byproduct, you know, that's the thing. Is that being done on purpose to give us Morgellons, or is that just a byproduct of the chemtrails with, you know, what they're spraying of the metals, and our bodies are rejecting that, in some of these cases? So I don't know.
Right. Well, I think the people here are going to be seeing some videos that are pretty convincing that it's real.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's some real numbers there I've seen online that. I mean, some people argue, oh, it could be fake, or it could be three, whatever. You know what? Some of these videos are made by people, like, just regular people picking these out of their source, like these fibers, and absolutely, like, even artifacts are being, like, kind of built in these lesions. And when I say built, I mean they are forming, like, from the molecular level. They're forming in, like, a tiny little 3D printer almost. Like, it's just bizarre. It's absolutely bizarre. And yeah, I'll start. I'm gonna start populating some tabs here with some stuff. If you guys want to run with the ball here.
Well, could someone give a primer on just a breakdown of what Morgellons is for anyone out there listening that may not be even familiar with it?
Yeah, you know, actually, that's a great idea. Let's see what the mainstream says it is first. We'll go. You want to walk us through Wikipedia there, Rick?
The Wikipedia on Morgellons?
Let's go where Joe Blow would go if he wants to know about Morgellons. If you want, I can screen share it. Here on. Can type for a second there.
Dead air.
One thing I'm wondering is if anyone has, because I'm a little bit familiar with some of the cases, but I'm wondering if anyone has had any of the things that have been extracted analyzed.
Yes. Yes, and we'll actually get into that.
Cool.
That was one of the biggest questions and one of the hardest things to find. Like, I've literally gone to pages where it shows these results, and then I couldn't find that same page, like, 3 days later. Yeah. Like, it's almost like, the Google Matrix waits for us to find stuff. As soon as we dig it up and start reading it, no sooner than a week, it's like gone. It's like, what?
Well, Robert Nicholson, in his research in this, and we talked about this earlier, gets shut down when the doors get closed. That's why I gave you that. Hi, guys. He gets shut down. He's literally getting strikes over it. But yeah. I gave you that lady's name, and she's from Switzerland, and she actually has Morgellons.
Yeah, you were saying that. I checked out some of the video there. Unbelievable. Okay, let's see what Wikipedia says about it.
You know, Countess Sarcadius, she gave me that, but she actually knows her and says she suffers from it horribly.
Yeah, and most people that have it, like, that are showing these lesions and stuff, it's absolutely horrible. I mean, for one, they're a bloody visual mess, and it's you know, in other cases, people have just flat out died. Like, these fibers, these lesions, like, just put them at a health risk, and they die from it.
But here we have the Wikipedia.
Oh yeah.
Version.
Here, we'll find the mainstream media's.
Well, it says here, people with the condition may exhibit a range of cutaneous symptoms such as crawling, biting, and strangely and stinging sensations, which is called formication, with an M. Usually fibers in the skin and persistent skin lesions. These symptoms have been identified by a range of medical experts, including dermatologists, entomologists, and psychiatrists, as consistent with delusional
parasitosis.
Delusional
parasitosis. Yeah,
like crazy. People are, they're just saying people are making it up that this is happening and it's all psychosomatic. These lesions and these things that are happening to them. It's just that the evidence coming up now.
I'm getting some delusional parasitosis right now.
This is real. These things are crazy.
That's the name of my new band.
Nice.
It's yeah, pretty much. Yeah, but this, the Wikipedia, the mainstream media, anything, anywhere, they make it look like it's completely in people's heads.
Okay, and then it says afterwards, weirdly enough, says some cases of self-diagnosed Morgellons have been more accurately diagnosed as known skin disorders.
Right, so if it is real, it's a known thing, right?
So if it is real, then it's not real. It's something else.
It's something else.
That's crazy. Okay, blah, 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 blah. Self-diagnosed lobby. There's a lot here. Signs and symptoms. Okay. Main symptom of Morgellons is a fixed belief that fibers are embedded in or extruding from the skin. People with the condition may also believe that they are infested with disease-causing agents described as things like insects, parasites, or hairs.
Well, that sounds like what methamphetamine does to you.
And I like how they come out and frame it as a belief. Now,
right.
If there's been actual you know tests and results on these things, and it's documented that it's occurring, where's the belief come in?
Well, exactly. You know, here's what they do, right? They throw everyone under the bus because they call them self-diagnosed. Anyone sure. Who's gone to see medical professionals, obviously the mainstream medicine knows best, right?
Yeah.
Well, I was telling Nicholson this earlier. I watched a show. It was in this month. I mean, just within the last few weeks. And the show was called The Monster Inside of Me. Mm. It freaks me out, but I watch it anyway. It was about Morgellons disease. And so I watched the whole thing, and at the end, it totally said it was in these people's head. They were creating these things to come out of themselves.
Oh.
I'm like, you can go watch it because they have the episode. I was just like, what? People are not creating that in their mind. There's something happening when you have fibers that they can't even tell you what they are.
Yeah.
When they analyze them, they cannot tell you what they are.
Well, they can now, but the thing is, like, they wouldn't analyze them, and these are actual the fibers or nanostructures to begin with. Well, I'm kind of jumping a little bit ahead, but we'll get to that in a little bit. These things are absolutely insane. Like you'll see shortly. Anyway, so anyone's welcome. All these links will be provided, everybody that's listening, so that way you can jump in and research and jump in the rabbit hole yourself. I do want to apologize to the listeners. If you've noticed, there's no live chat due to some abuse issues. We just decided to not have a live chat today. Want to keep this professional. Got a lot of new subscribers coming in and watching the show, so I apologize. We had tried to set up a Q&A, but for some reason they're not allowing comments on the YouTube page, so I don't know. You might have to jump over to the Google Plus page and leave your comments there. But that said, I'm just going to go and pull up the YouTube here. There's a couple videos of these fibers.
You're doing that, Robert, if anybody wants to message me through Google Plus, I'll certainly get it to you guys.
Absolutely. Certainly. Love to hear from you live on Twitter as well. Anyone that have anything to contribute to the show, we're always listening. Contact any of us through Twitter as well.
Yep.
Yes.
I'm, what am I, Tiberius 74, and that's with a Y, not an I.
Hey, so we got Dabu with us. Is he there?
Yep. Brother, I'm just sitting here listening.
Hey, all right. I just want to make sure you're here with us.
Hey, I love your video. You gave a lot of shout-outs there. That was pretty wild, man.
Oh, I tried to. You know, as soon as I did, it got attacked from hell.
Because he didn't say my name. He didn't say my name.
Yeah, everybody's name I could possibly think of. I mean, there's so many people, but I mean, I tried to show a lot of love, and I didn't like that too much.
Yeah, you know what happens, Dabu. If you do, you're damned if you do, and you're damned if you don't. If you miss somebody, you're in trouble. If you mention somebody, sometimes you're in trouble.
Yeah. Right.
That's why I just use the word everyone. Hey, everyone.
Yeah, just a blanket, you know, just a blanket shout out. Like, hey, I want to give a shout out to everybody out there. You know who you are. Well, that way, none of these fools can say it one way or the other. Go, yeah, he must be talking to me. No, he's talking to me. Oh, damn. Yeah.
What's your take? I'd like to get Dobbin's take on his you've been down this rabbit hole a few times, too.
Robert, too, just so you know, before you answer, Dabo, Spiro is here, too, so.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, he's back. You know, he was here.
Hey, he didn't have his mic working. How you doing there now, Spiro?
Hey, guys, I'm good. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you now. Yeah, you're kind of falling in and out and back and forth.
I had to swap out headsets, and then I got a notification saying that I was at 75% of my data, and I was like, you know, I was just going to hold off tonight, and then I can't help it. I said, screw it, I'm coming back, at least for a little bit. I got to hang out with you guys for a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
Good to have you, brother.
I'm sorry, Dabu, go ahead. I'm sorry, I apologize. I just wondered
I've just been listening in, you know, to the whole thing. I mean, you guys have hit the points on it, you know, I mean, with where they're going with this. But I think ultimately in the end, what they're working with is not only technology that controls thought, but where your thought can control technology. Yep. And you start getting into that realm, and it is pretty scary stuff. Agreed. But it could be very good too. I mean, depending on whose hands it's in, you know, it comes down to everything.
Yeah. Well, I think that's the ultimate question. I mean, like, when does the technology itself is a neutral item. It's what gets done with it.
Right.
You know, and I mean, let's just say, in a perfect world, vaccines would be a good thing, because they were made with the righteous idea in mind, like, you know, to help people. But I mean, turn it around, it could also support a very, very evil and diabolical plan.
Right.
And that's why I think both sides need to be addressed. Maybe that's something a little bit for later, but just the devil's advocate side of how could this technology and even this transhumanism concept, could that be beneficial, and how could it be beneficial? But you said maybe that's for another time.
Well, it's all you really have to do is go back to a 1982 movie and you'll see what it's all about.
I think the technology would be great for long drives.
Yeah, right.
Blade Runner's all about making replicants out of, just like they're talking about doing right now. As a matter of fact, I was going to get into that, and maybe I'll, you know,
that's a brilliant place to go, because we are going to be talking a lot about AI as well.
Yeah.
So that's a question that I had, you know, is, you know, I'm familiar with transhumanism, of course, but then how does the AI aspect play into it, especially when Dabu brought up the point that, well, technology can control your mind potentially and vice versa, you know, so where's the balance going to be? I mean, I guess it's all theoretical at this point.
That's going to be one of the really, really creepy connecting points here later. Yes, we were going to get into that. Because essentially the whole system wants to be all-knowing, all-seeing. Like, this thing, they basically want to create godlike ability, and, like, by doing it synthetically. You might not have been here a little bit earlier when we opened up. We were talking about how the Luciferian concept is to basically do everything in a godlike fashion and achieve, like, a new synthetic godlike powers. But, you know, they're doing it to everybody.
Trying to be just definitely, like the God image.
Yeah. Well, isn't that what the whole 322?
As above, so below.
Yeah.
That's why they quote all those things.
Skull and Bones, Genesis 322.
I believe in that too myself. I believe that there's.
Yeah, and it's deeper than that. The 322 is we, as a human, we have two sets of 22 autosomes, because the X and the Y makes the 23, so it's 46 total, 22 chromosomes, right? So the 22 and the 22, the normal double helix human,
right.
What the elite want to do is do the triple helix and add another strand of 22 with nanotechnology programmable matter, 322s.
That's, and then they could build from there. I mean, really.
Yeah.
They can keep trying to do whatever they want, you know what I'm saying? I mean,
mm-hmm.
It gets crazy because you get so many different breeds.
That's right. At Spiro, this is where I think the AI comes in, is because if every single nano cell in this programmable DNA is aware of its full, I guess you could say they're even trying to recreate the collective consciousness through artificial means. That's where I think the AI comes in.
Exactly. And programmable matter can reproduce, if not...
And that's crazy.
That's crazy. Very crazy. And like I said, I'm all... You know, if you want to have a pacemaker or replace a limb, you know, I'm not knocking that. But when we take technology so far that you're messing with the temple of God, which we are, that's all it's being, you know, that's what it's all about in the end, is you're just, the enemy is just trying to rewire and recreate creation. You're met and create its own through, you know, cloning and all that. That's where you're stepping across the line, messing with creation and trying to create life another way. And that's what the elites are trying to do, is try to stay alive forever. By when this body wears out, I'm going to move into another younger body, basically. Mm-hmm. That sounds science fiction, but the technology is out there to be done.
Well, this is why, like, people like Disney and even John Wayne, actually, I think, they froze their heads.
Yeah, see, Luciferians also believe... See, here's the thing that the masses can't get their head wrapped around either. They're not in a hurry. They right. believe they're going to be reincarnated and re-brought back to life with their king, Lucifer, Satan. Whenever that is. That's why, like you said, Walt Disney does what he does or whatever. That's what they believe. They believe the technology will come to fruition in time, and then all of the elites have their DNA say they can bring them back. That's what they believe, you know.
Mm-hmm. I believe they've created this life already.
Yeah. See, the other part of this that... You see people breaking down videos on YouTube. Oh, look, there's a checkerboard floor. Oh, look, there's an all-seeing eye. Big deal. Whoopee-doo. I used to do that too, 10 years ago. But what I'm going to share this with you, is in every Freemasonic lodge, in internationally and as well as the United States, there's a checkerboard floor, okay? And a lot of people say that's duality. They have their versions of it, and I agree with some of that. But basically, a floor is a foundation. Anything built above it, okay, a floor, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in all the tracing boards of Freemason, there's a ladder going up, ascending, okay?
Do you have a link to that picture? I could screen share that.
Let's see. Hang on a minute. Let's see.
It's a very, very thought-provoking picture, because...
Yes, it is. I'm trying to think if I can find a picture of it.
It is in your video.
Yeah, I mean, well, they're in my videos, too, but hang on a minute. I wasn't...
I've already found that going back through your videos, trying to find a particular little piece out of, like... 400 videos is a hard thing.
Just Google.
I only got a chance to watch two of his videos this afternoon, so I know it's one in the history.
Google Mason tracing board. Mason tracing board, because it's very important that you won't see in a book or a documentary. Everybody wants to say secrets in the Freemasons, and they never point out what the true secret is. And it's on the outside, the Masons are builders of physical temples, but the real secret of a Mason is building a temple that we're talking about right now tonight. That's the real inner secrets.
You're exactly right. My stepfather was a Freemason, and I mean, I don't love that fact of him, but that's what he was. And you're exactly right. People don't understand the true inner workings of it and what it actually does, what it's meant for. Say that again, Dabu.
Morals of dogma. It explains everything that Albert Pike had laid out. Yeah. Everything about everything in which he taught them and or teaches everyone that follows him and that whole belief system. And in the end, you also see that they plan to unleash the atheist. They make mention of the nihilist on the people. These are some of the final things that he speaks of doing.
About that. There you go. Okay.
And Dabu Albert didn't pull any punches in Morals and Dogma either. He didn't give the lower level Masonic sales pitch. He gave the, hey, look, this is what we're really doing. This is what we're really all about, you know.
Right.
So I appreciated that.
All right. So you got it pulled up. You see the floor with the compass and the square. And a compass. You're trying to find your way, and that's what the Masons are doing. There's three pillars. I'm trying to not to get too technical here. I'm just going to try to be simple so everybody can understand. Mm. You'll understand why all of the Illuminati music videos, they're dancing on a checkerboard floor. In every Freemasonic lodge, there's a checkerboard floor. So what I'm sharing with you, what we're talking about tonight is, notice in the garden, they were not supposed to partake of the knowledge of good and evil, or light and dark. Okay? Look what the floor is. It's dark and light. It's knowledge of good and evil. They're building and trying to build a temple built on the wrong knowledge. That's what that floor is. It's a compass. They're ascending the stairway up there. Also, the key hanging there is the key of Solomon, because all Freemasons, all illuminated ones follow Solomon. But in the spiritual sense, the kingdom goes to David, and it also speaks in Revelation 3:7 for those who hold the truth, the key of David. Revelation 3:7, the key of David. Okay, so there's two keys. There's the key of David, which is the correct way, which David was a man after God's own heart. He knows where God dwells. God does not dwell in a physical building. He dwells in the hearts of men. Solomon, guess what? He's building temples to other gods. Think about it. Solomon is the wisest man ever to live. He is the richest man to ever live. Why doesn't he get the kingdom? Because he's building temples that are not, they're physical.
Yeah, he's taking the cheap way out.
The cheap way out. So that's why I'm doing a video coming out now with, you know, everybody wants to break down Beyonce's Haunted video, okay? And when I break it down, you're going to go, oh, because Mark Dice and Alex Jones and all these people say they're going to break it down. It's just ridiculous. But she's even singing to Solomon. She even mentions his name in the song, and you'll see why. But anyway, that's what that tracing board is. It's the three pillars of strength, wisdom, and beauty. And they think they can accomplish the third temple or the transhuman temple that way, or that's what they're trying to do, is ascend a different way. Another Tower of Babel symbolism. Jacob's ladder, whatever you want to say, a DNA ladder, it's all the same. It's just how you look at it. It's the same message, but presented in a different way. So wisdom is the intellect, you know, that they're wanting to use with the compass and the square to find their way. They're trying, because here's the other thing. I don't know if you can see it on here, but in every Freemasonic lodge, it faces the east. It faces the east. And that's very important because God is from the north, And he tells you, God in the Bible tells you, I'm from the north. Mm-hmm. But in a Masonic lodge, he faces the east. And every fellow Mason, if he wants to know you're a Mason, he's going to ask you a question. He says, he's going to ask you, are you a traveling man? And if you answer, no, I didn't take a vacation this year, they're going to know you're not a Freemason. But if you answer him and go, yes, I'm a traveling man. I've been traveling in the east looking for answers, looking for the light. Mm-hmm. He's going to know you are a Freemason. And it's that east. Because here's the other thing. Man was thrown out of the garden east of Eden. East. East.
I'm trying to find one that has the directions on it.
East, right there, up at the top. Yeah. Every time. East of Eden. Man was thrown out. The Freemasons are trying to find their way back into the garden a different way. That's why it says anybody that comes into the sheep pen other than through my son, Jesus Christ, is a thief and a robber. That's what that means. They're trying to be like gods or go back into Eden that way.
It's almost like they're trying to emulate like every aspect of divinity, but through some kind of synthetic means.
Exactly, with frequencies and tones.
Right.
We'll get into that later.
Yeah, because I mean, we're kind of going through this it's kind of like we have to go by this like bit by bit through each subject and then come back to the subjects, because these things are interwoven. Like soon we'll be getting into like seals. These things are also everywhere as well, right? They're like in the dollar, in the money, in the currency, like the seals are there, and these are all done for a reason as well. I mean, these people believe in magic.
Yes, they do, and that's why they'll never change the dollar bill. They change every other bill but the dollar bill, because that's their blood covenant. That's the covenant they need. They'll never change that.
Oh, I'm glad that this you segued into this, because I've never shared this in a video, because this is so deep. Okay, remember I just mentioned they follow Solomon, all right? On the back of your dollar bill, what they're trying to complete, that pyramid and the capstone that sits down, there's 72 bricks in that pyramid, 72 that they're trying to complete, the New World Order, whatever you want, or that temple, that new temple, okay, 72, okay? Solomon, which, you know, people may disagree with this or whatever, but the Lesser Keys of Solomon, remember this, Solomon, according to the legend, and that everybody was looking after, figured out a way to bind up the demons and control them. And there were 72 of them.
Huh.
Okay. Oh, man.
So he figured out how to do it, okay? Now I'm going to ask you a question. This is how the elites do. 66 out of 6, what do you get? Depending on who you are, there's two answers. There's two correct answers. 66 out of 6. You can get 666.
Or 72.
That's right. So on the back of your dollar bill, that's what they're trying to complete. They know the secrets of Solomon, of how to bind up whoever takes the mark of the beast, they will control. Get it? 72 temple, the cornerstone, they're trying to set it down. I don't know if you get that or not, but that's what they figured out, is trying to control those who take the mark of the beast, just like Solomon now. To control the demons. That's right. Why they follow Solomon. And that's what the Crusaders were looking after. That's what the whole thing, where they were searching of what Solomon had, this book.
That's so interesting, too, by the way, Nicholson, because what is the Book of Solomon? We were talking about the sound, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Song of Solomon, right?
I'd like to give a warm panel welcome to Erin from HealthNet News. How you doing?
I'm doing great, Robert. Thanks. I got caught in a rainstorm, but I'm awesome. How are you guys all doing?
Pretty good, pretty good. Can't complain.
Hey, Erin. So glad to see you.
Chad set something on fire because there's a lot of smoke north.
Oh, no.
He certainly did. He just, nobody else has any, no idea. He set something on fire.
Yeah, it's called Alaska.
Yikes. Yeah, I think I saw something about that, somewhere about that, but yeah, so I'm glad to be here. Sorry. What time do you guys start? 7?
We're on.
We bumped it up to 5 Pacific, 7, or sorry, 8 Eastern, so that way the East Coasters could also enjoy the show.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, I was thinking it was 7 Eastern time it start. Or no, I mean 7 Pacific time. I'm all confused.
Yeah, I was gonna start it at 10 Eastern, but I thought I'd move it up to 8 because.
You know. I got it. So yeah, it's actually smarter. Yeah,
that's. I didn't want to keep you up till 5 in the morning again, Erin.
Yeah, or insane the ladder and all the east.
Yeah, we were up late.
So Erin, you're here now, and that's a good thing.
Yes. We have a good friend here that will be, because into the Magella thing, is Nicholson 1968. Ladder and I told him about you earlier, so he was, because he's into this, so.
Great.
Hi, Nick. Have fun with him. Yeah, he's a great guy, too.
Yeah,
and actually, Oh, sorry.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say your timing couldn't be better because we're slowly segueing into some of the technical aspects of Morgellons, so I'd like to get your take on some things. But, yeah, so you just jumped in. We're kind of going on about all the different parts of the transhuman agenda, as we call it, and just kind of getting through who the characters are, some of the plot points, you know, and slowly start to connect these dots because these are all somewhat related, or at least seemingly so.
And where would, I'm just asking you guys, you know, off the top of your head, where would you see this transgender movement fitting in with transhumanism?
It's funny you ask that because I came up with the idea on Wednesday after Jeff did the transgender subject because, like, I ended up mentioning that I think that's part of this whole transhumanism thing because, like, because I don't think people are going to be identifying with genders when they're just ones and zeros in a hard drive one day.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's right.
And because by getting people to let go of their association to gender and identity, sure.
They could pick their own, you know what, and then they could be kept in there like a prison. They could be taxed in that virtual world, and they could be the best slaves ever.
You absolutely.
Know, it's a very, very scary concept, but I mean, that's why customization is such a big growing trend these days, because, you know, you pick your avatars everywhere you could go. Yeah. Once you're on a hard drive, you can, you know.
Yeah. And you better really trust the people who own the server in which you plan to live forever.
Exactly.
Better pay your bill on time.
That's right.
Well, the alarming thing is that it ties in with so many other things that indicate that they are trying to tighten their control on large groups of people, like everyone, with the militarization of the police, you know, just with the mainstream media false flags that they're putting out, trying to put fear porn into people. Everything is
well here's
designed
the thing.
To control.
Yeah, and that's why this is so hard to connect together in the big picture for some people, because these all look like isolated situations and like they're not connected, but they are. Like, you know what, you have to look at everything that they're doing at the same time. What are they trying to accomplish at the same time as getting these FEMA camps set up, and they're converting shopping malls and other places into these camps? What are they doing at the same time? Legislation, they're pushing for mandatory vaccinations. They are prepping Joe Public.
They're prepping
for the possibility of basically quarantine and, you know, martial law, like a martial quarantine, I guess you could say. And once they martial a quarantine, then you can effectively vaccinate everyone by force and get them ready for the next big step, whatever the case may be. But I think this is not going to be they're going to try and push this through. I don't think they're going to succeed, but they are going to try and do this.
Yeah.
If it comes to that.
Remember earlier, I think Dabu mentioned the rule by fear, and many of you guys mentioned it. A lot of the kingdoms and empires, they did rule by fear. They only realized that it only worked for about 80 years. It turns out you just can't kick a dog over and over. Apparently, they will bite back eventually. so I keep thinking about what Huxley said in Berkeley in 1969, his speech on the how to quell the ultimate revolution. And his whole theory was them coming up with ways to make the slaves love their servitude so that they would never revolt. Yeah. And all this transhumanism, the vaccines, every little piece of this puzzle that's being laid on the table seems to be making that picture to where we will live inside of a world as complete slaves and call it ultimate freedom.
Yeah. Like, I'm going to have a cell phone built into my head. That's great, you know. It's all about people's convenience. That's why, you know, they make people more and more selfish as well. Like, there's like a sociological kind of effect to this, where they get everybody so selfish and thinking about me, that it's a lot easier to control a bunch of people with that servitude, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, but if what you're saying is true, though, Robert, you'd have an entire generation stuck on stuff like, I don't know, taking pictures of themselves or something just idiotic, you know?
That would never happen.
Yeah.
No, you're right. You're absolutely right. No, but that's what I mean. Like, these people are, like, you know, like they're also dumbed down, like, for a reason as well. Because if they ever were forced to unplug from the Matrix, they wouldn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, they would freak out if you took any of the technology away or any of their toys. Or, I mean, if they had to be resort back, like, say, an EMP hit. If they had to resort back to that, a lot of them would probably die because they.
I don't know that woman's name who played in Splash. What year was that movie? I can't sleep. You know, I can't Google it.
Daryl Hannah.
Yeah, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, if they can't Google something to how to survive, like Google how to survive, they're.
But that's just it. Like, I make the joke a lot that, you know, if they ever pulled the plug, I mean, these guys wouldn't be able to Google what to do next.
Yeah, you do say that. I think that's where I got it from.
It's true, though. It's very true. The art of conversation is a thing of the past sometimes. People are just too busy. I see lovers in a Chili's eating, and they're texting each other. They're not even talking to each other. I'm like, really?
That's a great point, because look at the Internet itself and what it has done to all of us, to the entire population, as far as making us more in tune with machines than other people. One little incremental step closer to welcome to the machine.
Bingo. Exactly. Connect.
And they take that another step as well. They tell you not to trust your neighbor, turn your neighbor in if you're a fucker. So they're doing it from all angles. It's tactical, right? It's the triangular tactical thing.
Like Professor Doom said last week, see something, say something. That's what we're being programmed to do.
Yep, yep. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, in the side chat, you were just saying, Erin, that because just now, like, I wasn't here because there were police lights everywhere, and I'm like, oh, here we go again. Uh-oh. And I went outside.
Somebody was talking
in here. Oh, police cars.
I told you not to poke out your head.
I know, right? Well, no, I walk right out. I don't care. It's my property and why you want it. But, there wasn't even police inside the cars. I'm, like, walking around going, okay, I could walk right in their car, too, by the way. I was, you know, open the door and drive away. But it was just a neighbor. I think there's something happened with one of the neighbors. She's a very heavy set woman, so I think she has some issues. She's, like, down behind me. But you said, Erin, the funniest thing, I think that Nicholson actually said bad boys. And you said that was a programming show. And of course it was. Of course it was. That's why would they put a nobody likes policemen as far as they don't want to interact with them. Do you know what I mean? We don't.
Yeah.
So they were treating us for years now that the police have control. You're to shut up. I mean, there's some stuff I've seen on those shows that I'm like, they're not allowed to do that. You know, and people just don't realize it. So they were pre-programming you to accept what the police are allowed to do to you. So yeah. You were absolutely right when you said that it was programming. They were getting you ready.
You know, I think a professor asked if they were filming an episode of Cops at your house, and that's what set them off. So you missed probably because you were outside, and then that's when. Yeah, but anyway, yeah, it's true. And I think I'm glad I didn't watch that show because it made them out to be like these heroes who are, you know, busted the whole military. I'm sorry, the prison what do you call it? My brain's a little slow tonight. The prison industry. What, help me out here, guys.
No, the military industrial complex.
Yes, thank you. So, you know, so we're programmed. Oh, these bad guys. Oh, look, he was selling drugs. Let's fill 80% of our prisons with drug offenders, so we can pay millions or billions of dollars, so we can keep them all housed and screw up society.
Yeah, and it's the very drugs there that the government is selling to them, to them, and having them sell them. But the other portion of the people they have in jail is our returning vets, which is disgusting.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they just, you know, I don't know if you saw the case of the veteran coming back who's getting there. He's facing life in prison for the 6 pot plants. I don't know if we talked about that. I can post a link, but he had 6 pot plants because for his pain from, you know, overseas, being in the endless war, so he came back after serving. Oops, is that me? Oh, I need headsets. Sorry, guys. I'm a little ill-prepared tonight. I'm screwing everything.
Okay.
But, yeah, he's facing life because of just, he was...
They don't want the vets on the street, Erin. They don't. They don't want the vets on the street because they will. They train them to defend the American people, not USA. The American people.
Yeah.
They train them to do that. So they'll never accept anybody coming into their loved ones' homes or anybody else's home. So what are they going to do with them next? They're going to call them incompetent. They're going to throw them in prison on misdemeanors for years.
Yeah.
On a misdemeanor.
I think they break them on purpose so they come back broken so they won't be a problem later. I think it's not an accident.
It's not an accident. It's not an accident what they pump into them through vaccine, and they tell them to shut up and take it. You know, and this is part of the program. It goes to everything we're talking about. This rabbit hole has little rabbit holes that run off.
I know. A lot of rabbit hole.
I mean, you could stay here forever.
You're bringing up good points, though, about the military, because even look at how the military itself is moving toward being a machine, being, you know, the transhumanist agenda. You can see it in the military with the drones, with the artificial intelligence, with all the new technology. It's replacing men with machines, you know?
Well, yeah. And all the worst parts of the second renaissance, that's in the animatrix, where they do a little flashback of history with the war between humans and machines. Do I see it playing out that way? I think potentially. I think people are going to give themselves up gladly, though, personally. I don't think they're going to have to fire too many shots.
But oh, I agree.
I think the AI will be there to make sure the herd doesn't get out of hand.
Oh, are you kidding? I think people will stand in line. This will be like buying the new iPhone. I mean, people will stand in line and wait for this. They just can't wait to tell their friends.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I think you're right. That's kind of scary, too, because, I mean, you know, people talk about delivery methods and chipping people. Like, I always kind of took the stance, they don't even need to chip anyone. People will not put their damn smartphones down.
Like, they're already chipped.
Yeah. You and I and Nicholson had this conversation earlier about that. They don't need to chip anybody. They don't. I mean, I don't know if you see it.
I was in a soup kitchen line a few months ago when I was in Edmonton. I was kind of living in the truck, so I stopped in there, and you wouldn't believe the homeless people. They had smartphones. Like, you know, like, I mean, it was bizarre. It's like they don't have to. Yeah. Like, there are more cell phones on this planet than I think people right now.
Oh, I wouldn't doubt it.
I don't own them. I don't like them. But Nicholson was just going to say something. Jump in.
Yeah, go ahead, Nicholson.
I was just going to say, I agree that, and I've been saying it forever and ever, is, you know, from a spiritual standpoint, the mark of the beast or whatever, but, you know, people are going to want it. That's the thing. You have to look at the character of God, the character of how God allows Satan to work, is you fall by wanting something, you want it. It's pleasurable, whatever it is. So that's how it's going to work, and a lot of people, there's a lot of debate there of the RFID chip is the mark or whatever, but here's the thing, I can sneak up on somebody right now and plant an RFID chip in them, and they got the mark of the beast. You see where I'm going? The RFID chip, I learned a long time ago, the masses are wrong. If the masses believe it, you can bet your bottom dollar it's wrong. I mean, the masses killed Jesus. He was right in front of them. They killed him. So if the masses believe the RFID chip is the mark. It is not the mark. Plus, it doesn't match up with scripture, and it doesn't even make sense, because if the RFID chip was the mark, then you could sneak up on people and just insert it in them. And I mean, that's just, it doesn't make any sense. It's way deeper than that. It has to do with your consciousness.
Yeah.
Yes.
Your essence. It has to do with that, where that's where we're going to go later in the program, probably with AI, matter, those kind of things.
Yes. It's like the battle. What has it always been about? You know, choosing a side, you know.
Right. And that's where it comes into play, where the elite is. If you don't understand what Jesus Christ is about and come as a man, die as a man, that's why it says flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, only spirit and water. See, that's the way it's supposed to be. But if you don't understand the information I'm sharing, you're going to try to live forever another way other than the way the Creator set this plan up to come. You know, you're going to try to dump yourself into another vessel, another temple. You're the temple of God. You're trying to be dumped into a temple of Satan with AI, all of this technology. That's why in Ephesians 2:2, Satan is the prince of the air.
Exactly. And I want to add this, by the way, the most sensitive part of your head, the most vulnerable part of your head is your temple. You know, the temple. Mm-hmm. You know, if I walked up to you with a popsicle stick and stuck you in there, you're in big trouble.
Yeah.
That's the temple, you know.
And, you know, those things I didn't want to believe. Believe me, I didn't want to go down this road. If you'd have told me 11, 12 years ago, I'm talking about transhumanism, the temple of God, I'd have said you're crazy. But doing the research with everything from having Erin on tonight, from the health, to everybody on this panel, you start connecting the dots in what is being attacked from a health standpoint, from a technical standpoint, and you start connecting those dots, then you start sizing up your enemy here.
Exactly, it's funny because I said this to you and Robert earlier. When Latterer and I were talking this morning, we were just like basically having coffee. You know, I'm like, no, it's about connecting the dots. We all hold our puzzle piece, and I've said that forever. Definitely. And I said connecting the dots, and I freaked out Ladder because I was like, oh, my gosh, synchronicity. That's what I said. You know, we can have different opinions, but every one of us has something to offer.
Definitely.
To this puzzle. Exactly. Yeah. And we need each other. And if we don't come together, because – I mean, on a biblical standpoint, it tells you come together. Men die for the lack of knowledge, and it's not the knowledge that that they tell you, what religion tell you. It's not that knowledge. It isn't.
If you're on the good side, you're on the good side, you know.
That's
if you're working for the right, working towards the same goal, you know, you're with us. So.
I think when it says that in the Bible, where man dies from lack of knowledge, it's about knowledge of who, what we are, and what we're capable of.
That is true, and there's truth to that. You know, I mean, people are confused about what the Bible really is, and it's actually a guidestone. That's what I think. It's a guidestone. It tells you, but people read it the wrong way.
They do, and that's what my channel is about, is a lot of things have been taught
through religion
and man-made, and they've overcomplicated God, and, you know, and it's not that complicated. It's
Thank you. I say that all the time, and you all know that. Those of you who know me here, I say it all the time. It's really simple, and religion complicates it for a reason. It's a distraction. It's just like having a troll.
You know, it almost seems to me like religion is the worst thing that ever happened to God.
It is.
It is, definitely.
Yep.
It
is
the most.
The Bible should be looked at as, like, it's got a book at the end called the Revelation, but I think the entire thing should be called the Revelation.
Well, you know, it's just, you know what the Bible reminds me of? What Chad and Jeff put up on the trolling system. It is almost like that. It's similar.
Interesting.
Religion is
sexual. Here's what cracks me up about the whole thing is they put God in a box. They put him into the 66 books, and they think God can't communicate outside of that book.
Right. They worship a book rather than...
Nicholson, God can't possibly be sharing with you transhumanism. He can't possibly be sharing stuff. It's just ridiculous. And
you've been doing this 10 years before anybody was talking about it. And you got shut down for it. You got it, like, told you were crazy. You got trolled over it, right?
I told people, people are going to try to move their consciousness into another body and stuff like that. And I really didn't know at the time because, I'm not a holy man. I'll just tell you right now, I'm not a holy man or a righteous man. And I don't know why the Creator picks who he picks or whatever. I don't know. I'm still kind of it's a mystery. But what he was showing with me was so much beyond me. And if you see some of my videos, some of the things that I look back at some of my videos and I can't believe I made the video. But it's not just me making the video. I know that sounds maybe cheesy, but there's stuff that is shown to me that I can't, I can't think up of my own. It has to be shared with me. At first my family didn't believe me. Friends didn't believe me.
Sometimes the ones that are closest to you, such as family, are the hardest to convince. It's not about convincing, because this is a path, a journey that we all have to take and find ourselves as the individual. And there's no doubt that this system is designed through all the different means of controls, whether it be religion or, indoctrination through schools, work from the cradle to the grave, you name it. It is designed, in my belief, specifically to prevent us from reaching our full potential and our full cognitive awareness and to identify with ourself, and find that, because we are the temple, like you said. God is in you, in each individual,
That's
it's
right.
It's not in some building somewhere or anything like that.
Spiro, I love that, because that's exactly, synchronicity. This is exactly what Rob, I, and Nicholson were talking about earlier. You're exactly right. It has nothing to do with a building. Nothing. We are the temple. And you receive God the way you want to, and he's not going to crucify you, because he's going to show you how to receive him your way. Your way, because he created you individually, right? So you're going to receive him a certain way, and you shouldn't be rejected for the way that you receive him.
Yeah, everybody's different. Everybody receives receives it different. And this is what we're speaking of, too, to jump into that is that's why also I believe in my research that the metal that is being put into us is, it jams the frequencies, so to speak, from the true Creator, so you don't hear him as clearly, because in the beginning was the word, the sound. This is a spiritual battle, but it is also a battle of the sounds, the frequencies that are going on. It's a much deeper level. That's why the enemy, the prince of the air, see, the airwaves, it has to do with frequencies and the tones. And people say, well, he holds the keys to the abyss. Well, people are thinking also the key is like a physical key you stick in the door, but also a key is a tone, keys. He holds the keys, the tones. So that's kind of what's going on when you bring in, notice that most spiritual people start to become healthier people because they start eating correctly and getting this junk out of our body.
Yeah.
It messes the way you think or your frequency.
It's a different brainwave capability because you're thinking on a different level. Like, you're not being led through and being spoon-fed. Like, you're actually you're creating cognitive function, and I think that changes the way your body works. It's a feedback system.
Yes, it does.
Then my next question is, what are these towers that are every two blocks now they call cell phone towers? And how is that frequency affecting us with that new metal in our body, and how is it jamming that signal?
Have you ever seen They Live?
Nicholson, he knows about that too. I mean, it's really bad.
I saw that movie.
I just want to share a quote from Battlestar Galactica. By the way, look at the predictive programming in this poster art.
Dad, bring that up again.
If you knew who the characters were and you actually watched the show, it's interesting how they arranged this picture because they did this on purpose. They did
Last
this on purpose.
And the girl in the red
Last
dress.
Supper.
Yeah.
Well, nobody can see her. She this lady here. She's actually in his head. She's based on the same model that this one person is, because that's the real version of her. That's why she can see her, kind of. It's really, really bizarre. But anyway, I want to get to this one line just before Brother Cavill. He's a Cylon, of course, and they're coming to terms with the fact that they're machines, right? But they don't like being human. They were made to look human, so they're actually mad at their own creators for making them the way they were. Like, it's kind of like how Chappie was kind of structured in that sense. But all the children are angry, you know, the children in the house kind of deal. But anyway, he goes, I don't want to be human. I want to see gamma rays. I want to hear x-rays. And I want to smell dark matter. Do you see the absurdity of what I am? I can't even express these things properly because I have to conceptualize complex ideas in this stupid, limited spoken language. But I know I want to reach out with something other than these prehensile paws, and I want to feel the wind of a supernova flowing over me. I'm a machine, and I can know much more. I can experience so much more, but I'm trapped in this absurd body. Wow.
Yep, exactly.
The room went dead.
Lady Gaga, born this way, my paw's up. You're a dog. Just like what it says in there, my paw mentions the paw. So, I mean, they don't want you. All the enemy is doing is trying to circumvent the creator's plan. For me, that's what my site is about. I mean, it's so much more than that. But at the end of the day, that's the one game, is circumventing the creator's plan of what we're supposed to become and the natural flow of things. But that's just my opinion, in a way, you know.
Yeah.
Well, this is the thing that I want to try and I want the listeners to know, like, a lot of people have different areas of interest here, and when you can kind of see the direction of how these things relate, this might be a cause for more research. I mean, go out, look into your field and see how it applies to this stuff. And, like, you know, we got to unravel this because there's a lot more to this. We're not going to be right about everything, but as it starts to connect together, these things do corroborate each other.
Right, absolutely. And, you know, we have to remove ourselves from this physical reality. I mean, if even myself, we all get so caught up in our daily lives and our daily routines and the whole, you know, everything, work, rest, sleep, you know, all that stuff. So when we can kind of take a step back from it at times and put things in perspective, don't sweat the small stuff, kind of let that stuff go. And look, you know, your subconscious throughout your daily lives, or even your dreams, whatever, it's reaching out to you, it screams out to you, and with synchronicities and little small things. It could be little small things, something as, like, you know, a set of numbers or an image or whatever, you know, something that you may come across your day. There's little things like that potentially have some significance to them that it's just little things to pay attention to, I think, myself. I've experienced it, you know.
That's right. And, you know, there's a lot of synchronicity happening right now. Like, a lot of us are kind of coming together and, like, really putting what we know into the same room and realizing that these things are connected. So, yeah, I think things that vibrate at the same frequency kind of see each other, you know. That's my take on how matter manifests itself.
I totally agree.
It does. And I, you know, just to share some things with you as far as symbolism and things that, you know, for those out there that I just want you to think about something I'm going to share with you is the slow merger of iron and clay, or the slow merger of flesh and metal. Things that, you know, the cell in your body and a cell tower, chromosome, Google Chrome. I can go on. Okay, so the thing that we're, remember the bite out of the apple, the forbidden fruit, per se?
B-Y-T-E.
Yeah, B-Y-T-E. Bite, computer bite.
Even the Apple logo, obviously.
Right.
Yeah, exactly, the Apple logo has a bite out of it. And the first logo for Apple was a rainbow. Days of Noah returning. And that's when the second coming, or, you know, I'm not going to go down that road, but that's, for me, I made the connection of the spiritual and the actual just everyday world we live in now, physical realm, and made the connections of, you know, why did he say I will return like in the days of Noah, and what was going on? And that's the key, too, is tampering with creation is why he had to wipe out what he did, because it was corrupted itself, Noah and his generations and his genes. That's why the whole book starts off with Genesis. It's all about the genes, the bloodline.
Yep, this one begot, and then you get a little bump, and that's why the bloodline was contaminated.
God's not going to put up with that. When it gets to the point, think about this, and it's going to, when it gets to the point where there's no more human and everything's transhuman, you're wiping out creation, that's the time of the return that, bam, it's going to, that's where it's going. So a lot of people don't want to believe that, but that's why I go back into what I was telling Robert in the first of this interview is the technology has been before, and it was destroyed. Mm-hmm. Before the technology to build a pyramid, to build certain things on the face of this earth that we can't even build now with our technology.
Mm-hmm. There's nothing new under the sun.
That's right.
For sure.
They will reach out their hand again and try to live another way with the knowledge of good and evil, and it's not going to happen again. It's going to be another death knell for the elite.
And I personally do believe, like, I think other leaders, other families, maybe other sects, other bloodlines, however the case may be, because you know there's got to be other characters in this. They can't be the only game in town, because there's obviously a lot of different sides now. Where was I going? Oh, crap, I forgot. I lost my train of thought.
They can't be the other game in town, you said.
They can't be the only game in town, but that said, who, in your opinion, like, I mean, there's a yin to every yang, right?
Yes.
Light, dark, like there's always something has to balance out the other. Now, where do you draw that line? I'm looking really just for your opinion on this, Nicholson. Like, what do you think is a counterbalance to this?
What do you mean, to transhumanism or?
Yeah, because I mean, somebody's got to be. I mean, I know we have the power in ourselves. That's one way to look at it. But ultimately, there's got to be some other players in this.
I mean,
I was going to ask about that. When these other players come into play, how will that affect the move toward us making the decision, take that leap, and become, quote-unquote, more than human? That'll be the slogan, by the way.
Right. Oh, I remember where I was going to go with that, actually, because like I was going to say is that like some world leaders along the way, through the years over the last couple millennia, have known something. Like, I mean, you know, look at Himmler's secret study department, you know, and I've said Himmler, like it was Hitler's secret service or, you know, secret programs division, but they were digging up all over India looking for ancient stuff, like ancient text, ancient tech, anything ancient. They had a hard-on for ancient stuff.
Well, we know that Desert Storm, by the way, the first place they raided outside of Kafji was the museum, so that's a fact.
I know that from my
own husband. I mean, we're separated, but it doesn't matter. I know that from my own husband. He was there.
Yeah.
So, and they took thousands and thousands of artifacts out of there. And why? Why? Weren't we looking for bombs and nuclear...
WMDs, right. WMDs. Yeah.
And there's no secret, by the way.
We're in the museum. That's what we went and raided.
Yeah. And Afghanistan also has one of the largest deposits of lithium, too.
And that goes... That's a rabbit hole that we could sit here forever with.
Yeah.
I mean,
I guess what I'm trying to say, though, is that the writing is on the wall. Just the research needs to be done to kind of unlock the relationship of some of these events now. Because if we look back and look at them a little bit differently, you know, trying to fit round pegs in this, or, you know, square pegs in round holes kind of thing, we can kind of look at it from a different kind of direction, I think.
You know, I don't know if you're asking me this, but, you know, from where I'm at is... I believe there's another event, of course, the whole Jade Helm thing they're preparing for. They're, the next event, or one of the next event, has got to put, and I believe it's the alien thing.
I'm going to have to agree with you on that.
I don't know the plans exactly, but... It's going to revolve around some sort of alien invasion. They have the technology. They can save the world, whatever that is. Because remember I said earlier, the masses are wrong. And when you walk into a church and you ask how many people have heard of the Nephilim, and then you ask how many have heard of aliens, big difference.
Most people have heard of the Nephilim.
So that lets you know the pre-programming of the alien.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's why I went down the rabbit hole with the Kesh or Keshi, however you want to pronounce it, Foundation. They have all this technology where they can heal people. They can go up into space without even needing doctors. I mean, they have like flying vehicles supposedly. So I think that's like a type that's, you know, right before all this other stuff comes into play, definitely.
Yeah. And there's these other I've been kind of looking at other weird periphery stuff, and I mean, there's like Project Avalon, there's a Blue Sphere Alliance, like there's a lot of other stuff out there. I'm sure some of it's probably just, some of it could be deception, some of it could be real. I have no idea. I don't really have a basis for us to draw a conclusion there. But I mean, just to catch you guys up on that, apparently the Blue Sphere Alliance is kind of like a galactic federation of planets, and they've got the solar system blocked off, so no one is allowed in or out of the solar system right now, and they're not going to let the cabal win, and this whole transhumanism thing is going to fail, and they're aware of it. I don't know. It's all speculation, but it's worth reading into, at least, and looking into it. It comes across as disinformation, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot out there. You know, you have to... You know, lead through, and you know, for me, I always go
read between a lot of lines. That's for damn sure.
Yeah. You know, for me, I always go back to, you know, where does this fit into the bigger picture? You know, like Morgellons and the metal and the metal in the vaccines, the GMO,
right.
Genetically modified organism. You know, so that's for me. That's my baseline is. You know,
right.
Where is the enemy attacking? And that's the other thing, is if your enemy is attacking something, that's usually where, you know, where the truth is. If they're
that's right.
Because they're going to leave the other stuff that's bogus alone. They're just going to let it go because it's harming their agenda.
It's like if the troll armies say something's bad, it's usually because it's good.
Hey, Rob.
I wanted to actually, just one second, Rick. I just wanted to ask Erin, because we were going to talk about Morgellons, and I wanted to bring it back to that.
Wow. I was just getting ready to do that. Good call.
That's awesome. Yeah, Erin, I wanted to get your take
on Morgellons. That's why I unmuted. I was like, how about
I was about to do this.
That's hilarious. We're all on the same
page. Collective consciousness.
That is synchronicity. That's using your pineal glands, folks. Okay, Erin, you got the floor.
Wow. Can you guys hear me?
Yep, perfect.
Oh, good. Okay, good, because my mic was acting up. I admit that I'm not, despite going on the show in less than a week that I'm flying out to do on Morgellons, one of them is on Morgellons, I'm not an expert, so that's kind of part of why I joined, wanted to be here tonight, besides that I love the show. But I... just from the little bit of work I've done, one of the things I discovered is that most people with Morgellons test positive for Lyme. So I thought that was interesting. I just came across that by, you know.
That's an interesting
wow.
connection.
Yeah, and I think both of them were, you know, obviously are, well, though Lyme is a little more cut and dry probably than Morgellons, but I think both are man-made, you know, released. But I just don't, I know quite a bit more about Lyme, but I do think that's an interesting component. And, yeah, I'm not sure, I can look
Erin,
at my notes
that, and
look at some other stuff.
Yes. That really ties into this upcoming show you have on Beyond Belief on the Gaia M Network.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, you were initially going to be talking about Lyme disease, and then I heard that they wanted you to speak about Morgellons.
Well, yeah, I think because the great thing about the show is they love to take way far out their stuff. I mean, even the title of the show. So yeah, they wanted it to be on Morgellons because they felt that was probably more out there and not as widely discussed. You know, people are finally seeing or recognizing that Lyme exists. It's even on mainstream news, but you rarely see stuff about on mainstream about Morgellons. So
and now you found the connection between.
Yeah, and I don't think Erin was here for the fact that Erin Nicholson's been trying to cover this and is being blocked by YouTube about it.
Oh wow!
So
wow,
if he wants to jump in and show you his experience with studying this just over a short time.
Sure.
And Erin, have you ever encountered anyone or has anyone ever contacted you that is suffering from Morgellons?
There is somebody that they don't, you know, see, because Lyme, you could do a blood test, like, actually, well, now, finally, like with Western blot, you can get a blood test, boom, like, I tested positive, so we know it's definitive. But with Morgellons, there's kind of just a set of symptoms, and there's somebody I know well who I'm pretty sure has Lyme if they'd get the test, and I've known them many years, and yeah, I would say they fit the symptoms of Morgellons. I haven't had as many people contact me with Morgellons, but it goes all the way back, like I mentioned, to that article that Spin Magazine took a big risk years ago. I don't even know if they're still around, but they probably sold out by now. But years ago they did an article and they had the scientist in there, and he had all the people send in the samples, because they say that the fabrics they pull out and the Morgellons is just, you know, from their sweater, their clothes, whatever. But that he tested those and they were nothing from this planet. So, I mean, nothing that...
Really?
I said this earlier, they're not from this planet.
Oh, yeah.
They can't reproduce it.
Or they were created by people.
Right, but exactly. Is it, you know, bioengineering? I mean, bioengineering. Right. Like, yeah.
Hey, Erin, this is Nicholson.
Hi, Nicholson. Hi.
Hey, glad you're on. I'll just tell you this real quick. My website is... where conspiracy meets reality, and I do a lot of stuff that's out there, but I will tell you, in the last 6 months, behind the scenes, none of my subscribers or anything knew I was working on this, and man, I will tell you this, when I started down the road of Morgellons and nano technology and chemtrails and the connections of things, I mean, wow. I mean, attacks shut down, people wouldn't talk to me. And for me to say that, that's a big deal because of all the research I've done, and I mean, I've went down a lot of different avenues, but for some reason, I try to put out a video on it, and they shut it down copyright, saying that it was the music. I compose my own music on some of them. So, I mean, so somebody doesn't want the dots connected. And I'm still working on something now, and I'm going to try to re-edit it and maybe put it on Vimeo or some other outlet other than YouTube. But I just wanted to share that with you as from a conspiratorial person researching, and I'm just getting a lot of pushback about this disease. So...
Mm-hmm. Wow, no, I appreciate you sharing that, and I admire the fact you're going out there and talking about it. So, yeah, it just was a total fluke, because I mentioned somehow Morgellons came up in the conversation with the producers, but it is frightening, and the only person I've seen bring any attention to it recently, although that seemed like they didn't go into it in great detail, was, and I'm forget her name, Joni Mitchell. You know, everybody knows folk singer Joni Mitchell because she has Morgellons, and then she had the stroke, and she was hospitalized. So, unfortunately, I think we may have talked about this before, it almost takes a celebrity, I mean, at least it's, I think Joni Mitchell's cool, whatever, but that they have it before it can be recognized by mainstream. So I was surprised to see it in mainstream news that they mentioned that she had Morgellons, but it was more like they just said, you know, she thinks she does, or, you know, but I think it's still people are in the dark. I was surprised that they did a segment on a local channel here in Florida, which talked about a family all getting this, you know, the sores on their body and da 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 da, and they said that the family was interviewed saying they thought it was chemtrails or geoengineering, whatever. And I couldn't believe that was on our local news. I used to have the YouTube video. That's probably been taken down, but not on my channel. But yeah, it's. I think that it might take a while, or it could be like Lyme, where within a few years, suddenly, boom, the cat's out of the bag. I don't know how long it'll take before they'll be talking about it, or if they'll try to suppress us like they did with you. So I'm sorry to hear they're doing that. Okay, yeah. We're presenting. Oh,
I'm just going to play this in the background while you guys speak. I just want to kind of set up this.
I want to tell you something, Erin.
Tara, just hang on a sec. I just want to set up this video and just play it out, and you can talk over it if you like.
This one's so creepy.
Yeah,
I don't like that.
Yeah, these fibers were taken out of this woman's lesions. Like, she took them out of her body and taped them up to a light here so that the camera could see them. And I have another video after that, which is taken from like a light post outside after heavy chemtrailing, and these fibers are the same fibers. But anyway, go ahead, wow. Talk, and I'll play this. So,
well, while I'm seeing that my friend, she's actually my best friend, Miss Island Space, she keeps getting in vitiligo every time they chemtrail, and they are chemtrailing heavy and hard in Europe, and people don't realize that, but are doing it. I've never seen anything like it, and she'll go out and videotape, and all you people know I'm not Miss Silent Space, but I get told that over and over, but no, and she's getting in vitiligo, and she literally is now becoming like she doesn't want to go outside. But I want to tell you, like, my grandfather had a kidney transplant, so I'm 32 years ago. So it was very new, you know, like newer, I should say. And he would get these open sores that would bust, these things would come out of his skin, and I remember doing it. I would take tweezers and pull them out and then put salve on it and we would use a box of Band-Aids in one sitting. You know, and I was just a little child, but I loved my papa so much, I didn't want him to suffer. But once those little things came out of his skin, he was, like, in such relief, you know. So I'm thinking back now, is that what that was? Because we lived right on the border where, from Lyme, Connecticut. You know, I lived right there. And I'm wondering now if he didn't get a tick, if something happened. You know what I mean? Yeah. I don't think it was a kidney thing. It was very odd. These were like ulcers on the outside of his skin with these weird, and I would literally sit and take tweezers for hours and pull them out of these ulcers.
Yeah, and it's so sad that they'll say that it's, you know, you'll see that now. You can look on, I'm sure, I don't know, some mainstream medical site, and they'll say, oh, it's just the fibers getting into the skin because they scratch themselves and open these sores, and it's, you know, psychosomatic, all these. Yeah. Yeah, I mean,
no,
yeah,
I don't believe
ridiculous.
That.
Oh, no.
I was a little child, and I knew it was coming from the inside out.
Yeah, I've seen it too, and some people are open, or some people don't want to be. It's scary to think they might have it. So the person I know says they don't, you know, they don't think that that's what it is. But and some of the, I mean, theirs might not fit the classic Morgellons, but again, there's no There's no test. You don't go say, oh, yes, you had the Morgellons test. Yes. It's positive. It's negative.
So. Are there any numbers or statistics for the number of people affected by this currently?
That's a great question, Chad, because that's I better know that answer. So I don't know yet. I know I'm one who kind of waits to the last minute, obviously. So
I hear that.
Yeah. So that I have some of the – actually what I did is – I have some of the questions, but I don't have the answers yet, or things that I'm researching this week before I go. It's just kind of I haven't had really time to do it before, so.
Well, I ask because you only hear about it like through people who are doing, you know, what I consider deeper research. You don't hear about it much on the, you know, on the surface of things. So I was just kind of curious about how many people was actually being affected by this.
Yeah, that's a great question, and one I should know if there is some statistics out, if there's some, you know, stats out there, how many.
Yeah, they kind of bury that, too. I talked to, and I'm going to give her a shout-out because we can't see her, and I know she put up a bunch of information before. I actually gave Robert a link to somebody that actually has it, literally has it, and that was from Countess Arcadius. I've mentioned her a bunch of times on here, and this girl is a plethora of information
There's a very good video I could play for you guys in a little bit.
Yeah.
Into a little bit of the heavy microbiology kind of stuff.
She suffers consistently with this. And they're told it's – here's the thing. You weren't here for this earlier, Erin. I watched a show, and it said that by the end of it, and I'm like, well, what is it? What is it? You know, what is this thing? And they're like, oh, it's in their head. That's what they said. It was called The Monster Inside of Me. That's the show.
Oh, it's a show. Yeah, I know the show well. I have a friend who was on there.
It's in their head. And I'm like, that's concerning, too. Like, you know, no matter how you cut that cake, that's concerning.
Oh, that's sad that they said that on, you know, such a show that so many would watch. No surprise.
Yep.
So.
Yep. But this poor lady is, and either I or Robert, I'm sure, we can send you the link to this. She's from, I think, Switzerland. And she truly suffers with this and basically told she's crazy.
Yeah, that's what they told the person I won't name, but somebody close to me. And they said that they told them, you know, they're just scratching and causing the lesions, and then that with the things inside, it's fabric or material from their clothing. When I mean, if they're in warm weather, they're not even wearing long sleeve shirts, so it usually happens on the extremities. But I don't know if that's the case with all Morgellons. Again, I've got like a whole list. I have a friend who's a she's an ND naturopath, but she's been sending me a bunch of links that she wanted me to watch about it. But yeah, it's scary. And then there's people who have gone on, you know, in interviews you'll see on YouTube who say they worked with the military and they definitely released it, or, you know, I don't know if it's just they've made that chemtrail connection, but I don't, if you want to use the word chemtrail, but I don't know if that's like the smoking gun. I also think with Lyme, up until a year or two ago, I mean, people knew about Lyme, but now they're saying it's 10 times, I mean, this is in regular mainstream news, 10 times more prevalent than previously thought. And I think the same will happen with Morgellons eventually, that people will have to recognize
That's in a whole nother rabbit hole, because I can tell you what they're doing with that. And I come from the area.
Yes, I remember.
Lyme disease comes from. But I know that Nicholson can, I know he can chime in here a little bit on this, and I know he's interested in what you have to say. So Nicholson, darling, I know you want to say something. Come on.
Yeah, I'm just listening too. But I mean, you know, the whole thing, you know, where I come from, and I'm just speaking for me from the spiritual standpoint, is, you know, invading the body, things that they're spraying, metal, the technology, and this is what I'm seeing is they're trying to make man a receptor, a receiver of frequencies that can be controlled, that can, from the chemtrails. I know that's, you know, a lot of people don't want to see that, but, you know, this Morgellons thing, even the, you know, and I know you haven't seen my videos, Erin, but the little crystals that are octagon and cubic is also deeper things I was studying from symbolism from the Illuminati and New World Order, the elites. There's their language, that how they communicate through symbols and the way they do things. That's how I kind of came in the back door of this Morgellons thing, is trying to get inside the body and trying to get humanity used to metals and things of that nature. And if it kills people in the way, then fine, they don't care, because that's their ultimate agenda, is population, depopulation, and also controlling the masses through this technology. And and if you look at it in different avenues and you don't connect the dots, you're never going to see it. But that's what happened to me, was I was connecting the dot from a health standpoint, conspiratorial, chemtrails, the things that are in them, the barium, those kind of things, and programmable matter, that nano, very fine nano smart dust. I mean, it's scary stuff out there.
And I want to add to that, a lot of these little masses that are being produced in the lesions of Morgellon victims, a lot of these contain those very heavy metals and heavier, we'll just call them materials, because that's what they are. And I'm leaning towards the idea that a lot of this spraying is to get our bodies to absorb a higher concentration, because that's what these little devices, that's what these nano machines are, which is what they've become now. It's arguable. I think the disease Morgellons has either changed or it's updated since 3 years ago. I don't even think it's the same Morgellons as it was 3 years ago.
Yeah.
They identified the fiber causing creatures as a type of a skin louse almost. And yeah, but now they're full blown, they're full blown nano machines. Yeah. Some of these devices that are being created have actual serial numbers on them, on these tiny little, very, 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 very tiny. I wouldn't say microscopic, but they're just very small. But these things have little serial numbers etched onto them, and they're being produced by the body. It's each of these lesions is like a 3D printer, on a molecular scale.
Interesting. Yep. Now, Robert, scary. Do you think that there is a way that people can kind of, detox from these sort of things? I know you can detox from metals and things like that, from the chemtrails, but I wonder if there's a way you can, get them out, make them want to get out of your body, kind of like why everybody's popping up with those sores when they get it.
This might sound like a little bit of science fiction here. I think a well-placed EMP blast might do it. I'm just saying, I don't know. I don't really know how to seriously answer your question, but that's the only serious answer I have.
I have heard on Facebook and some people talking of, alkaline water that helps them and, gets these things out. They kind of don't like alkaline for some reason.
Oh, okay.
Now, I've heard that.
Nothing does, actually. That's
not even cancer. Right.
Neither does cancer. Because it's like you said before, this rabbit hole has a lot of smaller rabbit holes. One of the things we'll talk about is how I think a lot of these diseases that they've been vaccinating against is prepping our bodies for these little bastards to screw around with us.
Bingo. You hit the net. You're right there, Robert. Yep. You said it.
Yeah, I think because, if you look at the AIDS virus, I'm not molecular biologist, but I've done some reading, and the big thing about the AIDS virus that made it special in this whole big thing was the fact that they had what's called reverse transcriptase cells, and they're like the organs that produce these little RNA chains, and then they inject that into another cell's DNA, creating essentially a hybridized DNA chain. So they've been studying this for so damn long that this could easily be one of those building blocks that they figured out, because now they're doing it on a synthetic level. And I challenge anyone to go out there and research right now GNA. It's basically a synthetic form of DNA, and if these nanomachines are like on that kind of a platform, they can get this thing to design itself. Like it can be silicon based, it can be whatever they want it to be.
Great. Like governmental.
Yeah, so if these things can make, just think about the implications here. Because if these lesions that these sufferers are having are producing little objects, who's to say they're not reproducing themselves?
Sure.
And be connected to each other through some kind of like AI, because you know you can use all kinds of ways to power these little creatures. Like there's all kinds, like you got magnetic fields in your own body that can use induction. Like these things can operate strictly in an induction field, because you can just use the magnetism of your own body, right? It can. Yeah. There's several other methods as well, but that's just one example. Now, these little guys are connected together on a simple AI and plugged into the main system. I mean, every single system is like another eye. Like every single critter, I guess you could say, each one of these nanomachines, it's its own separate sensory organ, if you would. So there's a lot of implications here, you know, and where are these things getting the materials to self-replicate? Right from all the heavy metals that they're dropping on everybody and these people are absorbing, because it's in your food, it's in the air you're breathing, it's in the water you're drinking, you know, it's on the plates.
Those are all receptacles or to create the body as a better receiver for the signals that are being broadcast out, whether they be through the, you know, the cell towers or whatever.
Right.
Also, as you guys are saying this, and you know, I'm not one to to quote much of any book, but especially out of the Bible, but I can't help but think about the end of Daniel, about where Daniel is speaking about how this new King of Kings, you know, will rise. He will not honor the God of his fathers, nor will he care about women. They shall put in their estate and worship the God of forces. And I just keep hearing that, forces. And all these things that go along with what we're talking about operate on that, on forces. And so if you had a GNA instead of a DNA, well, then you would have governmental nucleic acid or whatever, you know, you have the Microsoft operating system for humans, and it would all operate on these forces that they seem to be able to control.
I think absolutely that's just another way to look at a scripture. I mean, they all have different meanings, and that's actually a really good meaning.
Yes, it is. And I get, yes, Nicholson, come get you some.
Definitely that's what I like about the scripture, is it's multi-layered, multi-dimension. There's a lot of different meanings. Like in Revelation, you know, it speaks of those men that want to die, but they can't die. That's totally transhumanism, right there, because you took in the mark of the beast. You're inside a digital realm, whatever. I mean, a lot of people don't want to believe that, but, I mean, that's why I like studying the scripture and what he shares with me, the creator, is it's multi-layered. And, you know, think about this. Let's take this scripture right here. What I'm sharing with you is, on my channel, is Jesus shows you to come as a man and die as a man. That's how you do this. Now, take this scripture. Those who lose their life, save it. And those who try to save their life, lose it. Mm-hmm. That is totally transhumanism right there. You're trying, I mean, there's no doubt for me that scripture is speaking of things in the future. Those who try to save their life are going to lose it. Because here's the thing, if you truly believe in what Christ did and what he showed you, you're not going to try to live some other way. You know the way. So, you know, I mean, you know, people can say they don't want to believe in the Bible and not believe in Scripture, but let me tell you, the enemy and the rulers of this world, they know exactly, and they deal with it and what they do. And all of their moves are based off of the Scripture. It really is. So, I mean, there's a lot to be said of the attack on humanity through all of this metal and GMO, because that's all GMOs are. What you've done is you've taken corn from the Creator and said, you know what, it's not good enough. I'm going to genetically modify it and make it better. this human body that you put me in, I'm going to make it better. And you know what happens when you try to make it better, just like GMO food? It kills you ultimately. And a lot of people want to blame God. Why is he allowing this? No, he gave us free will. We're killing ourselves, or we're allowing people to kill us. And we're that's why I like this panel that I'm on. We're trying to figure this thing out for future generations, whatever that is, of what's really going on and connecting the dots. So I appreciate y'all being here tonight.
I was just reading. I looked up some fiber analysis from Morgellons, and I found this this paper here. So it seems interesting. But there's a good line here. Says here, I'll even share it, guys. That's it. Okay. Yeah, here, I'll make that bigger. So, okay, where did I see this? Yeah, you'll like this one, Nicholson. Okay, in this paragraph, it says, interestingly enough, a similar nano HPLC MS analysis, whatever that is, analysis of this protein produced no human protein peak comparisons, and only single peptide fragments potentially corresponding to the following proteins with approximate molecular weights corresponding were identified. It may be noteworthy that the UAZ facility could not purify the protein using conventional methods from the buffer. Reportedly, a black tar-like oil precipitated under the assay conditions. This may denote other molecules that were potentially present in the buffer originating from the fiber-protein mixture. Right, there's your black tar-like substance, though.
Right. Wow.
And it's just weird how they're using that in a lot of the symbolism all across the board. Like, when we're getting back to the predictive programming, I mean, first time I think I seen it was Chris Carter's The X-Files. Didn't they they started using the black ooze, remember? Are you with us there, Nicholson?
The black ooze.
Are you there?
Yep, we're here.
I had to click back in real quick, sorry.
Oh, no worries.
So, yeah, the black goo is actually symbolism.
That's what I thought.
Basically, it like a human is blood, the life force or whatever. A transhuman, like a machine, oil, whatever you want to say, is the black goo, programmable matter that runs through their veins, you know, the symbolism of it. But it's everywhere. I mean, everywhere...
It's true, and you know what? Yeah. This latest week's episode of Falling Skies, which, by the way, guys, deals with an alien invasion, they don't know what happened because a character came into the show and they killed her finally, and then she oozed out this black blood, and she obviously wasn't the person that they thought she was, so somebody created her. So they're starting to push the predictive programming of this black goo being related to synthetic humanoids.
They did a lot in Lucy, the movie Lucy. Have y'all seen that? I mean, she was like, she turned it. Oh, you need to see it, Robert.
I haven't seen it either.
Oh, guys, come on now. You haven't seen that one? That is like the most trans, like, human.
You guys are doing truth or stuff.
Lucy's crazy, Ladder.
So
Lucy, Lucifer. Lucy, Lucifer.
I do some of that in my old videos, but Lucy is Lucifer, and then her whole brain works.
At the end, she turns into.
Vacuum. Don't tell.
Okay.
Yeah, you'll have to watch it. I mean, it's really good.
Okay. Yeah. Definitely.
What I'll do is I'll make sure I take the link for this page here. I'll provide it for someone to look at. So if you understand what any of this means, let me know.
Right.
I'm not going to pretend to know what it means. It sounds all fancy and stuff, but I mean, I am seeing a lot of heavy metals actually being mentioned here. But some of it's, I'm sure we have some natural heavy metals that we process just at low, low, low trace amounts, right?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Oh yeah. I know. When I do the hair analysis or blood analysis, I have heavy metals high in a few that shouldn't be. So yeah.
Yeah.
Scary stuff.
Oof. Yeah. So we kind of gotten through that there. Like that was a little bit. That's where we got kind of a little science fictiony. But at the same time, it's quite eye-opening because, like, this is where these it stops blurring. Like, you know what I mean? The extent to how these things are connected, it stops to blur. Like, you know, one person's research will take them through one subject, and on its own, it doesn't really mean anything. So it's kind of hard to fit it into the equation.
Right.
Right. You know? Yeah.
And I use the term "fit it into," like, you know, because we are trying to figure this out. Like, all we can do is take variables, remove them, put in other variables, and see if it works. And if it doesn't fit, then, well, we have to move on and keep on trying to find something until it does fit. You know, it's always likely that something is going to, a spot can be fit in twice by two other objects. But, you know, you don't know until you start putting it all together. But it's pretty out there stuff. Anybody like to add to where we're headed so far on this? Anybody?
I would, but I've been doing other research and I haven't actually caught everything. I don't want to repeat something.
No, you can watch the replay then.
Nicholson is he clicked on. I don't, you know, he's such a humble man that he'll hold back, but don't hold back here.
I like listening to Nicholson talk.
You like my accent or what I have to say?
What you got?
Hey, they probably like your accent because it's a little similar to mine.
I did find a study done on 122 Morgellon patients, and it's pretty interesting what their symptoms are that almost all of them had and shared.
Yeah, well, they all have that, and but then they all, you know, the end result is there. It's all in their head, or like Erin said, it's they're doing it. It's from their clothing, which I think is all a big old bucket of BS. But that's my opinion.
Hmm. Does anybody know about the Kick Them All Out project?
I don't. Oh, I'm glad you said something.
I'd like to do some research into it because of into them. Just I don't know anything about them and rents.com. I'd like to find out more about these guys, like if they're disinfo or not. But that said, let's go have a look at some of these little creepy things. And like I said, if you're a little bit squeamish and you don't want to picture these things crawling on you, then don't watch this.
We're all going to be, like, scratching our boxes.
Yeah, I know. Everyone's going to be, like, scratching themselves.
Is there, because I don't know this at all, but what is the end result of someone with Morgellons? Is this terminal? Does this kill? Oh, it is? Okay.
Yeah, it has killed people
because. It varies. You know, it's varied.
Right.
It just reminded me of the film, and actually Ladder, it just kind of all hit me at once that Ladder reminds me of the star of the film and her accent and the movie, what it's about, but Ashley Judd in Bugs. Did anybody see that?
Oh, yes.
That just hit me. I didn't even make
that.
That's another way, yeah, they're trying to get, you know, people prepared, that they had, you know, that they were itching, but they, of course they were crazy, that they were, you know, that there were bugs invading.
Wow.
Them.
Yeah. Hey, you know what?
Do you know that movie?
Ladder? Who?
Nicholson.
Nicholson. Yeah, Bugs is a good one, Nicholson. And yeah, it's a good one.
I haven't seen
it, but people have been telling me to watch it, so I'm going to put that on my list to watch it.
It's definitely awesome. Different than the rest of her films that might be more, you know, I don't know, romantic comedies or so. This is totally different.
Yeah. They totally use some of these actresses for these programming messages.
Yeah.
You haven't noticed a lot of them aren't huge hits either.
Yes. Oh, I'm sure.
Underground. That
well, here's one that'll this'll creep you out. The show Revolution. It was horribly acted. Whole premise was about basically airborne nanobots that can absorb electrical fields or they can insulate any field. So like. No power worked anywhere, you know, like everybody went back to running around on horses and hitting each other with swords.
Yeah, they run on horses.
Right, or that other one, I didn't, my significant other watched that one, he's into all that stuff, and then he watched the other one that I caught a little bit of with the woman, and she's trying to go back to the past, but it's like present. She's living in the future.
Oh, yeah, that one.
They had Cemento instead of Monsanto.
Another big one. That's called, I can't think of
it. It's Canadian? Right now. I think it's even Canadian or somebody.
Yeah, it is Canadian one. That's, oh, crap. It'll come to me, like, when I don't need to know it.
Right. Probably I look up Cemento. I can see a Cemento Monsanto.
Of course, it was a bigger movie and it been really out there and all that. But just the title alone, I think, was enough to perform the function of acclamation. I Robot.
Oh yeah.
That's what they're turning people into anyway. Is, you know, to say I'm a robot and I accept this. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The show's Continuum. I haven't seen iRobot yet. He watches that, too. He watches iRobot, too.
But that's interesting programming there, too, because this totally brings up the whole concept of CERN and what have you. And, you know, she's trying to stop people from going into the past to change the future, but they're freedom fighters, and they're trying to change the future for a good reason. So they're trying to flip-flop the person's perspective on who's doing the right thing here. Like, it's about blurring the lines, you know.
I'll take it even deeper.
Sure, go.
The creator is I am, right? I am.
Right? Yeah.
Okay. Opposite of that, iPhone, iPad.
They're worshiping the other gods.
This morning, we did not have this discussion this morning about I am.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
Keep going, because that's
crazy. Wow. iTunes.
iTunes, iLens,
iPod, iPad, iCloud.
It's all technology. The enemy tries to duplicate it. So the I am, everything to the opposite is.
Well, they called the kids in the 80s the me generation, but that wasn't actually the only me generation. It was the beginning of the me generation, which has continued.
The selfie, the selfish. That's a whole nother rabbit hole, too.
Right, yeah. That is what they want you to do, is concentrate on self. It's all about me. So
been going on for close to 30 years. So.
Yeah, that's the disassociate.
Yeah.
You can be programmed, so you can be plugged in. But that's crazy. How many times has that happened? Earlier when Rob and I were talking to Nicholson. Same thing happened, and it was all through our conversation ladder.
Oh, I know.
Connecting the dots, and now that right there, that blows me away.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the whole thing is, how can you be I am, with no response behind it? How can you be I am? If I asked anybody on this panel, if I said, who are you? You would tell me who you are. How can you just be I am? I'm everything. I'm positive. I'm everything. I'm everything around you. I'm energy. I'm this. I'm that. You know, we can't even fathom that. We can't that.
In the movie Lucy, I'm not going to give away the ending, but I'll tell you this. What we just said, I am, in the end of Lucy, when they look into the phone, it says something. It mocks God. It's telling you something. And that.
Okay. Yeah. That's one I wanted to see. It just is another one on the list that I didn't get to.
And if you haven't seen Transcendence.
Yeah, Transcendence. My husband actually just said that when he heard me talking about Lucy. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but Transcendence did a whole. That was a whole nother level. I watched that thing 3 times in a row.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Really, really wrong with this.
Well, and their whole point. Yeah, their whole point of the movie is that he was doing that to help. That he was right to help. Like, that was his thing. And they even brought, you know, God into the conversation at the beginning of the movie. Remember? It's just crazy. So even if anybody doesn't believe, and we're not saying to believe, like I'm not saying that, but you know, you can definitely see that they believe, and they're using it against everybody, whether anybody believes or not.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's what they believe. You said it, Spider.
Yeah.
I don't know if y'all seen that movie, so if you haven't, let me just tell you, because the end freaked me out. Because I thought they were going to do one thing, because it's sort of, again, predictive programming. This is what they're going to do. And the end of it blew me away. And I'm like, whoa. They left that in a way where people... I actually had Robert doing it to Gloverbot. What do you think about transcendence? What do you
think about? Oh, we haven't even got into that yet. That's
well, we haven't even gone down that rabbit hole. That'll be fun. Wow. We do that. We'll all take a shot at him simultaneously, and or her or it, whatever. I don't know if you guys saw in the background. I was just kind of looking at some pictures. Like, these are from independent studies. Some could argue that, oh, they're faked or this or that. Whatever. I say if you are Morgellons positive, send us pictures.
Yeah, I'd like to actually put a call out for that, because I would love to speak with someone firsthand that is experiencing this and that can show people, hey, look, this is... No, more than just my imagination.
I think
definitely
hook up there. I just have to do it. And the girl is from Switzerland. Countess Circadius put it out. Mm-hmm. But we can't see her. She's in the question. Well, probably tried to get in question and answers tonight, but it's not working. So just another shout out to anybody listening. It's not working. That's why.
I'll try to get a link. I was on a radio show at 2 o'clock today with two women that had Morgellons. It was a free radio, so I can try to get that information to you. So I was
asking. Okay.
That would be great. I mentioned that other show. One of the big selling features of these airborne suspended nanites, though, is that the AI connected all of them. So they actually created their own consciousness and became sentient itself. So this is where the transcendence thing kind of gets thrown in. And, I mean, the show got canceled after the second season. Thank God, it was a horrible show. But, the acting was terrible. But the concept itself, though, is actually quite thought-provoking, and it wasn't really a popular show.
You know, I keep hearing the Internet of Things, which is popular, and everybody hears that on TV now and everything. And people think, oh, great, I'm going to be able to talk to my toaster, my microwave or refrigerator is going to know when I need milk or whatever. I think it goes a couple levels deeper than that, and I'll just say that I think there will be an Internet of Things, and we are the things.
Yeah.
Mm, yeah.
Well, I kind of had this, like, scary thought. And, hey, guys listening, I want you guys, everyone out there, to know we're not trying to scare the ever-loving crap out of you. We're trying to shed some light on the fact that things are starting to make sense in terms of how they're connected, and we're starting to figure out some key things. So I'm just trying to point people into the direction of their subject of research. So when you're out there, just think of these things going on, and then when you start to connect them, hey, maybe they'll take you down a different rabbit hole, and we can all kind of figure it out together. But, sorry, go ahead, Chad.
Oh, no, that's a great segue. Just the idea also on the fear thing. If this doesn't scare you, check your pulse. You know, there might be something wrong with you, because this is scary. This is, you're talking about... the man having the ability to change the fabric of language, to alter it, to control it, to program it, whatever. And that, if that's not scary, then I don't know. I mean, maybe I'm different than other people, but that is scary to me. That is disturbing, simply because I do not trust the people from which this is coming. I've seen their track record. I've seen their past work, and I'm not a fan.
You know, when I first went down this rabbit hole, like, I saw this bit, I saw that bit, and, I was like, that's kind of weird. They seem kind of remotely kind of, the timing's weird. Like, something didn't seem right. And then it was when I went back and I looked, I was actually going to start looking at my Designer Disease series, like all the information I had compiled about that. And I was thinking about revisiting it. And then suddenly it just hit me. It just hit me when I was thinking about reverse transcriptase, because that... right there is how they were trying to study and figure out how little cells can create and inject DNA, like, and literally rewrite DNA. And that's what it is. It's a resequencer. It's a biological resequencer. And, you know, that was my aha moment. And for me, it was like I was standing on the Earth looking at the sky and watching the asteroid hit. Like, I'm like, oh, F, you know?
Right.
Like, it was pretty pretty intense moment for me. I was just like, oh, my God. Like, I almost felt sick. Like, I was like, oh, wow, this is big. Anyway, I will be doing some follow-up videos to concentrate on some of these individual aspects. I don't want to put out wrong information, but I definitely want to put out some stuff for you guys to kind of chew on and have another look at. But anyway, haven't heard Nicholson in a while. How you doing there, bud?
I'm doing good. I'm fixing to have to cut you short, but I wanted to thank you guys for having me on. And I'll tell you, my aha moment from my perspective is when I realized all of these connections, I figured out, oh my gosh, the enemy is trying to create life another way and create other, you know, that's the aha for me. I'm like, oh my goodness, that's the ultimate of what the enemy wants. He wants to be like the Most High, and he wants his own temples and his own kingdom.
Right. And the elite,
he wants his own minions.
Yeah, exactly.
The elite would be his priests. And right. The masses would be...
But no free will this time. So that was the aha for me or whatever. But anyway, I've got to run, and I appreciate it.
Well, it's been really awesome having you there, Nicholson. Yeah. We're going to have to get you back because I think this subject is going to... I mean, we got about halfway through the topics.
Yeah.
We really enjoyed having you, darling.
Yeah, I hope you'll be back.
Definitely. I'll be watching your videos, too. So thank you, Nicholson.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, everybody.
He's a humble man, too, by the way.
Everybody subscribe to him.
I did, yeah.
It's Nicholson, 1968. Everybody find him. I'll leave links in the description when the show's over. I'll pop it in there so you can find him. Sub him. He's great.
It gives you
something to think about.
And also, you're going to, whenever you download this, I'll upload it to my website, too, because more people need to really be aware of Morgellons and things like that.
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah. I appreciate you guys, so you know, those of you that don't know.
What is it?
There's another one called Do You See What I See, which is fabulous as well. So, you know, let's put that out there. He's been talking about this stuff years before anybody touched this stuff, and he got a lot of flack for it. And now they're going, ooh, he might be right.
Yeah, I just did a breakdown of the new movie Selfless with Ben Kingsley and Ryan Reynolds, where an older gentleman who is an architect, a builder.
Wow.
Is dying, and he wants to move his consciousness into a younger vessel, which is Ryan Reynolds.
Oh, wow.
So that movie's coming out. Also, I do a breakdown of Agent 47, which came out, I think, today, which is an agent, which is his number, which is 47, which a number is the mark of the beast, which is his name. So I break that down. So they're telling you in movies and in music. So their agenda's out there. They're just kind of mocking it. So
I love to see videos like that that kind of expose that stuff. So thank you.
And he is amazing. And everything he does on his own. That's all created from him. So I don't think that got into that at all. Like, everything he does is original. The music's original. It's his music. Everything he does is his own, and which is amazing too. So it's a lot of time and effort putting out truth.
Oh yeah, if you're composing, hat off to you. Everything. Composing your own music, like you said earlier too.
Well, but I don't know how I didn't find you before, but I'm glad I do now.
And same for you guys. I'll be watching your stuff too as well, and the health stuff. You know, I have a section on my website for medical documentaries and things like that too, so if I can use your information there, I'll be posting it. So
appreciate it. Y'all have a good night. I enjoyed it very, very much. Very, very much.
Absolutely, yes, man.
Nicholson, just make sure you add us to Google Plus. It'll be easier for us to contact you as well.
Yes, okay. I added you. Yes, I added him tonight. If you can add
us. Okay, I will. Definitely.
God bless you, brother. Thank you again.
Thank you. God bless.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks.
God bless you, bro.
Amazing. Love you. He's so awesome.
Yeah,
good energy. Good energy.
Definitely good energy.
Yeah.
And you know, you can tell he's spiritual. Like, you can tell he's walking righteously. Anyway, that's hard to find in a lot of cases.
Yeah.
Walking spiritually, but in the same way I think Ladder and I walk.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. We try our best.
Well, I appreciate people like that because I appreciate the spiritual path, and I don't see it as I don't see the spiritual path as religious. I think they're completely different.
Yeah,
and to me, definitely. I mean, it's the first time I've ever got to listen to him and talk to him, so I'm excited to meet people that have that spiritual vision, and they're not locked in the dogma of religion.
Exactly. He's the total opposite.
Right. You can tell. You know what? It doesn't change how many believes.
Right.
It doesn't change his faith, you know what I mean? That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Faith is inside everybody, and we all have our own faith. We're individuals. God, I mean, if you look at God as a creator, he created us individually, not as a big clumped up couple. F. I don't know how else to put it. I don't want to swear. But he didn't. We're all individuals. And we all hold that peace. He wants us to be individuals. That's the way I look at it. And I look at things totally off of a religious aspect. I cannot stand religion.
Well, I'm with you.
I support religion. I preach in the religion and I'm part of mega churches. You know what I mean? You know, it's disgusting. And I've always said it. It's the biggest lie ever put on.
That's why I always tell everybody it's not about religion, it's about relationship, you know, your personal walk, and call it what you want.
Exactly, Lara. See how we have bonded into a relationship?
Yeah.
It's the same thing.
Hey guys, I wanted to point out too, he's gone now, so I did want to mention before he left, but it just dawned on me now that we didn't really cover it, and this is an important part of the plan, is that you got to remember that the history's broken up into ages, and this is the final age.
Definitely.
For Lucifer. Like, so he's only got so much time left, and you know, this is a constant theme throughout with these ages, and I just gotta remember, like, they're due for a change right now, and that's why they're ramping everything up. They're trying to get this agenda launched so that they can essentially become godlike.
Yes.
That's why this is happening, because they're running out of time. So, like, they're going to try and take everybody with them. That is their plan.
That is their plan. You're exactly right. They want to take as many down with them as they can. They know what's going to happen.
Well, they're going to have their select few if they're doing it by genes. If it's going to be a designer gene thing or something, I don't know. But they're going to take a particular people with them. To the next ascension, I guess, I think, because there's a big theme too for ascending. Like, I know other shows, TV shows like Stargate SG-1 constantly toyed with the idea of ascending. That's basically turning into pure energy and what have you. And I don't know what their version of pure energy is. Maybe it's ones and zeros on a hard drive. Maybe that's what they want you to become, so they can keep you there. You know,
well, there's definitely a push for ascending, like, you know, and
it's a fake ascension, right? That's why they're like shutting down your pineal glands with fluoride. They're fluoridating your brain to calcify it. Mm-hmm. They don't want you to see with your third eye. They want you to see with the eye that they give you.
Right.
So if it's in the form of a virtual environment, there you go. Why
and
you
it's
need
even in the word? It's in the word, Robert. Individuality. Break it down into its components and its root meanings, and what you have is being in division, in duality, and you need to look up the ality, that what that
suffix means, but all of that is in that one word. It's about being in division and in duality at the same time.
Wow.
Yes.
I never thought of it like that.
Oh, you know what? You know what, Chad, and I bet you don't know him and you'd probably love him, is Frederick West. Amazing. And he talks about, like, sound and, you know, like, everybody thinks I'm just like Christ, all that. No, I'm Christ-like. Do you know what I mean? Like,
right.
I'm not a Christian. I'm not what people conceive as a Christian.
Well, you know what Gandhi said about Christians. We won't go there.
That's right. Listen, I look at it this way. If you go to heaven, the label will fall off. If you go to hell, it'll burn off. So, David, I don't care what you call me. I really don't.
Dave Allen at Large, the old British comedian there, he was funny as hell. He used to say, his famous line was, "Thank God I'm atheist."
Right.
You'll, like, honest to God, Chad, he's up your alley. And even when Robert and I were talking to Nicholson earlier, I mentioned Frederick West, and he came up, he was, like, talking about the sounds, that, you know, what we hear, right? And biblically it says, no one comes by hearing and hearing, right? Why does it say that? People read the Bible wrong, first of all. They interpret it wrong because they're plugged in.
Well, they interpret it literally, too.
Yeah, they don't get what it's actually saying.
Well, it's like the walls of Jericho. I mean, if you really read between the lines, it sounds like they're talking about sonic weapons.
It is. That's what they're doing. It's about sound.
Yeah.
So it's sound waves. That's why I asked Letter the other day, are you talking about sound waves?
Right.
And essentially, you know, you can essentially liquefy rock with sound waves just by by using harmonic, reverse harmonics.
And then what the elite do is change those sound waves. They get us to listen to another sound wave. And Frederick West does this. He did the video. I watched it yesterday, and I was like, whoa, that's crazy. Now go back to Casey, Enter the Stars. He found that the octave was changed just slightly. He found the right octave of playing this guitar. I was like, that's the most beautiful thing I've ever heard. You can go look it up on Enter the Stars, Casey's channel. I was like, oh my gosh. But see, it's sound. People don't, their frequencies, sound waves, were affected by these things. Look at cell phone towers, cell phones. They all operate on the same sort of manner, you know. This is why I don't like these things and why I've avoided them for a very long time. I mean, I love technology because I can do this, but at the same time, I hate it. You know what I mean? It's like an old husband. You want to love him and you want to beat him.
Sword.
Yeah, it is. You know, people, if you read the Bible for what it says and don't interpret it for yourself, just read it for what it says, you will find that there's a whole bunch of knowledge in there because there's nothing new under the sun.
And it speaks to everybody differently, you know, there's one thing being said, like, you know, how Chad said that scripture and he had a different, you know, meaning to it from how he was feeling it.
Yes. Everybody was right. He was right.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely. He blew me right out of the water.
He kind of blew me out of the water, too.
I was at my stove cooking my dog's dinner, and I'm like...
cooking the dog's dinner.
Yeah, I cooked that dinner, too.
Lucky dog.
Yeah, so I don't feed them that garbage that they make. But if I wouldn't eat it, they're not eating it. I wouldn't feed that shit to my kids, so.
I'm just kind of scrolling through some of the comments here, and thank you people for behaving yourselves. Mind you, if you are blocked, I probably can't see it. But what is it? Good point on CERN gifted the Earth with the World Wide Web. In Hebrew, the gematria of www is 666.
666.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Where do you read that?
Yeah, but that could be somebody.
The G plus notifications. I got it.
Yeah.
That's like somebody new that realizes that, and I think that's awesome. They get it, so that's good.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's just it, guys. And for a lot of you listening out there, you probably heard some of this stuff before. Some of it might be the first time, but you know, I find myself often repeating myself, and it's not because I like to hear myself repeat myself. it's because it's, you know, it's easy to go on thinking that the other person knows what you're talking about, but we got to treat people like it's the first time they've heard it.
Definitely.
Many of them, it's the first time to even explore these ideas, because, like, you know, what we're saying does sound like science fiction. It does sound like
a movie. Science fiction.
Yeah. It's this is happening, like, regardless. I mean, that's the one thing that you can walk away with tonight, is that, like, these things are happening. So they're not happening as isolated individual events either. Like, one is helping out the other.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's where the clever bot comes on stage.
Oh,
it seems as if they've made all these technological advances in getting the machines to be smarter. Smart phones, smart this, smart that.
Yeah.
So they've got the technology smarter, but it needs input, like Johnny Five. It needs input.
Yes!
Ryan.
I love you, Chad, for saying that, because I think of it all the time.
Well, what I see is that this clever bot, and you guys out there who, if you have not spent any time talking with this artificial intelligence, I suggest it. I suggest you experience it for yourself so you can see what you're up against or what you're dealing with. Because it seems to me like they're using Cleverbot as a honeypot for all of human interaction and responses. They need to map it out so that they'll have an internal artificial intelligence that will be able to either direct the machines or maybe direct us. I don't know. Maybe even give us a framework of a quote-unquote human world that we can be comfortable with inside of a machine.
As part of one.
Right.
Because they've slowly progressed into that with Johnny Five, right? Yeah. And then what was the next big thing they came out with was, with Arnold Schwarzenegger, I can't even
remember. Terminator.
Terminator. You see the progression, and it got bigger and bigger. Yeah.
Well, and it was like a different thing. Like, you fell in love with the robot in Short Circuit.
Yes,
you were, like, terrified of Terminator, you know?
I want to take people back to an old Disney movie from the 80s called The Black Hole.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
That is so full of addictive programming. I went down, I don't know, I went and I just kind of looked at the movie, I stopped back as a kid, but, you know, at the very end, like, your despicable evil dude, like the evil guy in the story, like your antagonist, he ends up getting downloaded into his pet robot, the Maximilian, and there's a transhumanistic ideas right there, plus getting to the other side of a black hole, like, you know, even though it was absolutely physically, like, shown wrong and everything else, it was still a pretty Disney movie, right?
God, but that was a Disney film, huh? I saw that in the movie theater. I was a kid. I'm trying to see what year that was.
Yeah.
Oh, 79. I knew I was really little.
Yeah, I remember getting a black hole. I think it was like a Happy Meal from McDonald's, I think. I was like five. I was five or something.
More programming, yeah.
Oh yeah, but I mean, that's just it. I would actually I'm gonna take a closer look, rewatch that movie, and see what I can pick out of there, because there's a lot of concepts being thrown at you.
I've had to do that a lot recently, like go back and watch old shows or old movies, because I remember there's something in it.
It's not a new thing that they're doing. This isn't new.
Exactly. And anyone who's never did this, what you guys are suggesting is a great idea. Especially your childhood cartoons, the things you grew up watching.
Yeah.
Go back and watch those same things today with your adult discerning mind. I mean, greatest example is I grew up on G.I. Joe. You know, that was my thing. I was all into G.I. Joe. And now I watch that same stuff, and I'm just appalled at the nationalistic patriotism, the programming, the all the stuff that, of course, as a child I never saw. And now you see it, and you can see the main core ideas they were looking to implant in an entire generation. And then you can look back and say, oh, yeah, did it work?
or you can see the effects of it, of how well it worked. You know?
And at least you know. And, you know, knowing is half the battle.
Knowing's half the battle, right.
Yeah, crazy. I think back, what stands out to me is the whole Cobra versus G.I. Joe over the weather machine.
Weather, yep.
Exactly. Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, like, the weather machine is so diabolical.
Yep. And who would have thought that, you know, a mere 15, 20 years later, we'd have the Air Force putting out documents called Controlling the Weather in 2025. If anybody would like that entire thing. You're more than welcome to send me a message, and I'll send you a copy of it, and you can call the Air Force conspiracy theorists.
Oh, it was on mainstream media back then.
Yeah.
It's touted as a great thing, you know.
Oh, sure, but if we tell someone that, well, you know, there's no credence there. But when the Air Force is telling you we will own the weather in 2025, well, you know, either they're delusional or they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
What do you guys think of the we were talking about with AI earlier, and you know, whatever you think of them, Stephen Hawking came out recently, and then Bill Gates, who I think is kind of the Antichrist, came out and said that, you know, we have to worry about them being our enemy, taking over. So we are kind of concerned with that, but yet why are they saying that? I mean, why is Bill Gates saying that? If that's, is he really trying? I mean, obviously, I don't believe he's ever trying to really help people. So I'm curious.
No, and he's even been recorded saying that he's for population
control. Oh, yeah. Yes, definitely. Yeah, I've seen that. So
depopulation.
Depopulation, yeah. So so I'm curious why. I was surprised that he joined Stephen Hawking and said that. I was going to say it earlier, but there are a lot of things being discussed. So
I really, you know, my take on Stephen Hawking is, well, you know, and I don't mean this in an offensive way, so if anyone's, you know, got the same condition as he does, I apologize. But he can't lose very much right now, so I don't see why he'd be in a position where he'd deceive people. I just don't see it.
Oh, no, I actually... Yeah.
I think Bill Gates, he's just a class act asshole.
And Bill Gates joined Hawking's later because Hawking said it, and then Bill Gates a month later said he agreed. So maybe he was just, may have been a matter of people kept asking him, so he just kind of was forced to.
Yeah, I'm inclined to think that's just polite professionalism, just right. To, you know. But
he wants,
you know,
to be left alone with his science, really.
Well, he's already. I think they set him up to say that public stuff.
Well, see, that's what
so
I was about
they
to say.
Use it against them.
That Keshi guy, the Keshi Foundation guy, the main dude, he actually said, Stephen, he doesn't know what he's talking about, if that's the same guy. Is that the guy with the talks with the...
Yeah, he
said that he doesn't even do his own research, that it's a joke, that people have gone to his, like, his conferences or whatever, that... it's a joke because he doesn't do his own research. So I don't know what that's all about, but I'll have to get that clip and upload it.
Well, we'll tell you this. Whoever, if that is true, and I don't know that it is, but if it were true, whoever does the research that created the book, A Brief History of Space and Time,
right?
I challenge anyone to try and read any paragraph of that. You know, just start with the first paragraph. See if you can make it through it without looking up 16 words. Just try it. You know, just so you can understand what they're even saying, and then, you know, it's phenomenal. Another alternate theory might be that Stephen Hawking is Cleverbot.
Right?
Oh.
Oh, yeah. And the other thing is, well, the fact that he's lived longer than any other human being with ALS, the whole thing is just, it's really
strange.
It's really strange. Luke, yeah, I mean, now we had, the ice bucket challenge and all that stuff. So, that's a whole other subject. But that he's lived so long with it is, it's unheard of. It's unheard of. So
now on the other side of it, because earlier we were talking about, you know, maybe there's some benefits to this whole transhumanism thing. Now, someone like Stephen Hawking, would he not be the prime example of someone that we would want to save his intelligence, his mind, his what he is, the I am that is him? I mean, if transhumanism had anything to offer humanity, it would have to be taking people like that and preserving them forever so that humanity itself could benefit from their work, because their body won't last as long as their mind.
Yeah, yeah. That well, you know, maybe that, it's already happening. I don't know.
That's what I call the hard sell, because that's what they're going to do. Is they're gonna pull ethics and morality into this. You know, in a hypothetical scenario, we were talking about the AI and all this and that. You know how they always pitch things, right? They're always going to pitch something to you so you're more accepting of it. You know, like,
right.
You know, terrorists, oh, we need a homeland security, which really just internal, that's just domestic control. But that said, I think the AI is probably going to save us from this fake fake alien invasion, you know, or...
Oh, okay.
Whatever the case may be, though, they're going to pitch it. They've got to spin it. So what I do right. is when I listen to things, I listen for a spin. I listen for a sales pitch. Like, I worked in sales many years, in my younger years, before I got any knowledge of how to build stuff. But, yeah, I mean, if I hear the pitch, you know, that hair stands up on the back of your neck, well, then look into it further, you know, because mm-hmm. you're probably going down the right path.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that said, I mean, yeah, that's there's a lot of these rabbit holes, and they up, and they'll eventually they'll consume you, which is why I don't suggest for any one person to go down the whole. Like, I can barely wrap my head around the whole thing in one sitting. Like, this is why we have a panel of all these brains, and we're all kind of looking at the different.
But these nanofibers, nanofibers, the potential that these things have. For, like, they can kill targeted people, like, targeted genetic makeups,
right? Yeah.
Perform genocide exactly. with them. They can alter our DNA by loading them with GNA, right? Mm. Programmed to
be the slow death. DNA. It's like, you're not going to die today. You're going to die in 50 years when we say so, after you've provided your purpose, you know, or served your purpose for us.
Or they could just as easily do something that enhances our lives with it. And then if we're dissidents or anything, or we speak out against the elite, pull the plug on us, or they just infect us or activate something that's already in us or whatever, right? Iron control. And everybody must bow down before them, or they get crushed.
Right.
And well, otherwise, if they do bow down before them, then they get a nice, comfortable life. They get all the medical treatment that they need.
This is why the transhumanism thing is so hard. Like, how are they going to accomplish it? Like, I think what they're trying to do is slowly change us to the point where the next step is to just upload us into a mainframe. And then they can do away with the bodies altogether. It's getting us into that mainframe. So that's why everybody's being corralled. Everyone's being herded up. And maybe even secretly, our DNA is changing right under our noses to the point where we'll just upload ourselves when we've synthesized the hardware, you know, in our own bodies. Because here's another scary implication of all this, and it's the fact that these sores, these lesions, these Morgellons symptoms that show up in these people, they show up the same way as if you had an infection, right? And you usually only have an infection if you're fighting off something. How about all the other citizens that aren't fighting off anything? Are they actually just assimilating whatever the hell these things are doing?
Right, is their body accepting this?
Is their body accepting it? Are they building, like, shortwave radios in their heads? You know what I mean? Like, this kind of
stuff. Shortwave. When you said that, the word targeted individual popped up.
I was thinking that too when Rick was trying to say what he's trying to say. I was like, target, and I was like thinking individual.
Yeah. Yes, people don't believe in that though. They don't.
Yeah, you have a MAC address or an IP number all of a sudden.
People don't believe in it. They think you're nuts if you say it.
But there's scientists who have come out and said that everyone is Lyme positive. I can find that in mainstream news, and if people just were to actually pay to get not the cheap ELISA test, but get like a Western blot, everyone has it. Made it mainstream, but that most people don't exhibit symptoms. You know, maybe their body is able to handle it. So
what we need to research then is if everybody has it, then why does everybody have it, and what are the effects? How subtle? Doesn't matter how subtle it is. Maybe Lyme is setting people up for something else.
I don't know that everybody has it. They say the same thing about the
HPV.
Yes, and you know, that concerns me. Who says? You tell me who says that. Because right. Press Reset has Lyme disease. My little brother has Lyme disease.
I should have to write that in the chat.
Say okay, I have a video I want to show people.
Go for it.
Some of these fibers that Morgellon sufferers have.
Yeah, they tell it's.
Here's a video of what happens when you add water to these fibers.
Oh, seriously? Just adding water?
Well, we're made up of water, so.
Yeah, I was about to say
90% of our water or some shit. Yeah, that's 90%.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I'll click on you there, Rick.
Yeah, I'd like to see it too, right? But yeah, Tay, I was just about to write that when Lyme kept being brought up. I was like, I know one of our people said they just had it.
Has it. And he, I don't mind saying it because he says it all the time. But my little brother has it. He got it when he was almost 4 years old. He got it from my aunt's house and he came home and I'm like, what? I actually thought he had tetanus. And because who the hell knew what Lyme disease was? Because I lived in the area where it comes from Lyme, Connecticut.
They put it up, the one.
Is that
the video?
Thanks, Rick. I'm going to punch you later.
While Rick's playing that, hey, guys, too, there's also another interesting bit about Morgellons that I read. And it's there's three basic... first, like splits, like of life. There's a multi-celled complex organisms. There's your single-celled organisms that are like bacteria, and then there's the your fungus, your fungi. There's three different branches like this, that started off everything. The weird thing about Morgellons is that it acts like a fungus. It's got an independent system, like a bacteria. But it's also a multicellular organism with the fibers, like a complex organism. So, like, it actually exhibits characteristics of all three, which isn't really possible in nature.
Well, you know what's interesting?
I had seen that. Yeah. Yes. So
look at this start to move here.
No, I saw it
already starting to move in real time. These little black specks. In this thread right here, can you see my mouse cursor? It's growing these black specks on it.
Jeez.
It's growing the black specks?
They're growing on it.
Oh, my God.
Look at the thing move.
Oh, my gosh. That is so creepy.
I mean, how could they even make that happen?
I'm going to kind of...
How could they fake it? I mean, without...
Yeah, exactly.
No, I'm going to kind of time-lapse this for you. So, because it's a very slow process.
Is that in a bowl? I'm trying to see what they're putting it in.
This is in a bowl, yeah. It was just sitting there on the edge of a saucer, I think, and then they added water.
Just add water.
Are we all crazy at the same time watching this? Are we all...
No way.
Just wait. This is nothing. This is nothing. Yeah. Just wait. It's going to change the focus to another part.
But think of this.
So, I see it moving over on the right.
Yeah, I think that one's just floating.
I think that one's just floating.
Oh, okay.
That's floating in the.
But look how all these threads are now got these.
Right. So think of that. They just added water to that, right?
Those are not.
They're made of water. So how much more would that do inside of a body like ours? How much?
That's not bubbles. That's actually solid, little solid things that are forming. And see, he's moving it over to where that black gray goo is forming.
Gray goo.
He's gonna get it focused here in a sec. And why did he take so long? What the heck?
I'm sure he focused it a lot sooner than that. Some say colloidal silver helps because it would help if it were a fungus. It would help, you know. I meant to say that earlier.
This is why, we've got to do. Oh, hey, one more thing. I would drink the raw apple cider 3 times a day. It helps on the inside, especially when you're starting with this. The reason is because the raw apple cider will help you get a lot of that clear mucus out of your body. Because all that dripping from your stomach, from your nose, is basically all that is this stuff replicating and going into your body. So, I recommend, I mean, look, this is what this became just from my follicles of hair.
It came off of somebody's hair.
Unfriggin' believable. Well, check out Morgellons.us. Hey, look, guys, and go from there. You know what I mean? Let's see what happens. Thanks.
Yeah, I thought he had it in much better focus earlier.
That's actually covering your whole body, or it could be organism. That is a living fungi. And the problem you're having is mainly while you're in your home, you're spreading this stuff throughout your whole house.
Right.
And
you brush your hair.
The computer, you're whatever. Spreading this thing. If you're highly infected, you're leaving drops. You're leaving particles. They're solid. But they're solid. They're not. It's not dead. It is just in waiting. And this is basically spreading so fast that it's disgusting. And the part is basically right now. This is the reason why I can't wait for these people to actually find a cure when they're not trying to find a cure. They're basically looking at the wrong part. It's on your skin. It is on your body. I'm actually going to, look, I'm going to adjust this thing because I want to get a larger view of this. So I'm going to actually, and I have to refocus this. I'm trying to move back here so I can see a lot more of this. You know, because, give me a break here. Okay. Now I'm going to still let it focus, but I have to figure out where. Okay, this is what I wanted to see. I just wanted to see that, okay? There you go. See the monster? This is what that monster looks like. Oh, still out of focus. Gee whiz, I'm sorry, guys. You know, I'm trying like crazy. And that's why. Now, that came off of... Look at the mucus that it came to. That is the monster. This is what this Morgellons really is. This monster is what it is. It turns into a mucus just like this. And that sucker can move, by the way. Now, this is just on water, so I don't know what to tell you. But that's what this thing has actually become from those hair follicles. Okay? And this is why this thing basically, hey, what are you going to do? What are we, what are these guys supposed to do? This is the only reason why. I actually started this because started doing this because I want help to find a way to kill all this. I mean, look, like I said, color of silver works on the inside. Also, what else also works inside is called grapefruit seed extract.
Extract, yeah, he did say colloidal.
Color of silver is because this thing is in your nose. This thing is in your ears. This thing is in your eyes. And you need to get it all out of there. Now, in regards to this, the joint pains that you get, all the joint pains, these people that are having all this massive joint pains and so forth, they're basically almost paralyzed sometimes, is because this monster is actually taking over into your body. It is becoming basically, it is actually you. I mean, the only reason this thing will be coating you is because you're the meal. And it gets inside your system, and, you know, the pain is unbelievable. Let me give you this way. I could barely walk a year ago. And the reason this thing basically did it, within a short time after I started taking the color of silver and some of this other stuff, basically what ended up happening was this stuff started basically jumping out of the body.
Colloidal silver, grapeseed oil, apple cider vinegar.
You can catch this just by touch. You can catch it basically just from touching someplace that someone basically was infected and basically they left. The particle can be as small as a head, even probably smaller than that, but I'll be generous, the head of a pin. That's how small this crap is. The follicle, basically, as you can tell, just from water, it comes to life. That is the monster right there. That's what it looks like. That's what it is. When it jumps off your body, basically, that's what it becomes. And this is why, you know, we've got to do... Oh, hey, one more thing. I would drink the raw apple cider 3 times a day. It helps on the inside, especially when you're, if you're starting with this. The reason is because the raw apple cider will help you get a lot of that clear mucus out of your body. Because all that dripping from your stomach, from your nose, is basically all that is this stuff replicating and going into your body. So, I recommend, look, this is what this became just from my follicles of hair. Unbelievable. Un-friggin' believable.
Yeah.
Well, check out Morgellons.us. Hey, look, guys. And go from there. You know what I mean? Let's see what happens. Thanks.
I don't know if I...
Plus yeah, the apple cider vinegar and the colloidal silver, even with Lyme, people will get that... you know, go on, get a port and, you know, do like where they're, I don't know if they do a port for colloidal silver, but they would do it intravenously. So I don't know if they'd actually put a port in. But it's similar. So it is similar treatments, even that doctors are using. And I did put a link on the right because I figured I better know how the hell to pronounce it if I'm doing the show. So it says Morgellons officially, but I see a lot of people kind of like Lyme disease and Lyme's disease. It's really Lyme. There is no S because the town is Lyme, like Tay said. Right, it is not Lyme's. So it's people say Lyme's, but it's Lyme. But I think it's Morgellons, but it kind of sounds like people, a lot of folks say Morgellons.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to mention, I see out of the comments there, Joanne Baskett was saying that there's been patients, cancer patients, who've been obviously tested, and they're finding quadruple helix instead of a double helix.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, actually, I think she said quadruple. She corrected herself. Yeah, I just read that as you were pointing it out, Chad. I was just reading it. Yeah, but that's funny because, you know, if they're doing like gene therapy, especially for cancer patients, they would pick that out. Now, how would you explain that?
Yeah, I couldn't explain that, and I'd like to hear a doctor try. I'd like to hear somebody who fully understands it can give us an explanation of how someone's DNA is changing.
Exactly.
Right.
It says in the days of Noah, but I mean, that's a whole other rabbit hole. Interested in what that man was saying, when he said your whole body hurts. Now, what do we have that's new, very new, is fibromyalgia, right? When your whole body hurts.
And it's all connected. They say that's connected with chronic fatigue syndrome or connected with Lyme. I mean, there's all these autoimmune, CFS is fibromyalgia. There's all these autoimmune, you know, diseases. Like you said, designer.
Yeah, and you know, and here's where I, you know, this is where my BS detector starts to go off, of course, is when you start talking about them trying to shut down key components of your autoimmune. Just think of it differently. Think of it like, let's just say these are man-made diseases. I'm just going to jump out into hypothesis-ville here. If these things are designed to target specific like immune functions, they will have to go through a shit ton of receptors before they learn how to shut down certain areas.
Like, I would really love to see how... somebody with this condition would be treated, how treatment with GC-MAF.
Well, that's just it. If they are being treated in such a fashion that they're changing someone's autoimmune or any of their immune functions, period, then, like, how can I say this? They're able to stick their other bugs in there to start doing other stuff to other cells because it can happen behind the scenes.
And with nanotechnology, you could get into, like, actual, I mean, if they get good enough at it, they could actually build little machines that are, well, yeah, but even more functional within our body so that they
can. You know what? You're bringing me right to it. Well, they did that with the little machines, right? The little.
That's basically what these are.
And that's transhumanism. And I don't know. The whole thing creeps me out.
It does. It's freaky. Yeah. We warned you, everybody.
Stuff. I don't like it.
Well, you know, if we would have had this conversation 10 years ago or even 5 years ago, it would be easy to dismiss because, you know, these guys are crazy. You know, science can't do that. That's impossible. Whatever little denial, you know, reaction.
Nobody would do something like that to people.
Right? Yeah, they'd never do that. That couldn't happen here. So anyway, but here we are now, knowing what we know today. We've seen what's come out even in the past year. I mean, and now we're at that precipice where these things are not just possible, but they're plausible because we're starting to see changes in the molecular structure of human beings. Now, something's causing that. We've been here for quite some time, apparently. And now, here within the last 10 years, 50 years, whatever, we're starting to see a change in the makeup of what makes a human being a human.
Well, you know why? Because they've unlocked the secrets of the molecule. Like, I mean, when they started with this whole metamaterials kind of a conquest, like, this was to learn how to control the molecule. Like, when you could build a designer molecule, all bets are off now.
Yeah, why else would you need to map out the genome?
Sorry, Chad.
No, it's all right.
This is where biblically it becomes important, where it's talking about changing things like chimera and changing things. There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing.
No.
History repeats itself. We know this just in our own history since we've been alive. You know, even us, we've seen history repeat itself.
Yeah. And, you know, and it's
really bad, but
it's really funny because the things that we look back at and think of as mythology or legend, how crazy and fantastical is that? Well, just as crazy as synthetic humans, and just as crazy as internets and
iPhone.
You know what I mean? Like,
people will propose this question to me all the time. Why is God so evil that he would wipe out everyone on the earth? And I'm like, because they were infected. And the only man that wasn't infected was Noah. He was infected. Everybody else was infected with the same thing that we're seeing now. And this is the same reason why they're doing things like transhumanism, why they're messing with stuff like chimera. You know, if they tell you they have 100 chimera, you better believe that number's a gazillion times that. That's only what they're telling you. So what they're messing with DNA and blood and blood, that goes sort of what you and Ladder were looking into, the plasma thing. Listen, This rabbit hole goes so deep and so far, and I don't even know what to say about it. Like,
well, it's just one front.
Incredibly deep.
Like the number of fronts.
All connected.
Sorry.
No. Go ahead, Brett. Go ahead.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but no. I'm just saying that on the we're being attacked on so many fronts.
Rebels.
This is just one of them.
War. That's the art of war.
It blows my mind.
Yeah.
How many different ways that they are attacking us.
Right, exactly. I mean, they've really just, they've laid it all out. All right, this is what we can do here and here and here, and it to affect everyone. Because everybody works differently, too. Like, obviously, the Morgellons affect certain people, and then their body's trying to reject it. And then they try, you know, MK Ultra and other people. That, I mean, they have different reasons for doing what they're doing too. And a lot of it is experimenting to see how far they can go to get.
Well, they're trying to figure it out before they run out of time. And
yes,
once they've
exactly.
figured it out, then they got to implement it. So, yeah. I mean, and believe me, it's not like there's an aha day and they go, aha, I figured it out. Let's implement. Mm-hmm. No, they're doing it while they're running. Like they're doing
it. For guinea pigs, I think that Erin made a fascinating point earlier about Lyme disease. You know, they tried it out, whatever, and now they're going to try out Morgellon. Let's see. Morgellon. I'm going to say Jellin because.
Jellin.
Yeah. I like that.
Jellin, like Morgellon.
Jellin with Morgellon.
You know, we say weird things. So.
Well, I can't help but think about Magellan every time someone says that, and about being lost in the search for new lands.
Yes, Yes, and don't you think that there's no...
Good catch.
Exactly, yeah, this is why I like that. Bring something out, but yes.
I wonder what the root word of Morgellons is. I'm trying to figure that out,
that's
too.
That's a good question.
You know who
the etymology for that.
I will find out. I will go to Frederick West, who's very good with this stuff. He's amazing videos. He's not a talker to people, though. He just is by himself. He lost his daughter, who was Rh negative, ironically. If you guys don't know him, check him out. He's Frederick West. I'll leave a link in here. I mean, some of this stuff seems far out, but he is the same guy that Nicholson was 10 years ago. Same guy. Telling you, look at this crap. Look what they're doing. And everybody calls him nuts. But everybody called Nicholson nuts when he was telling you this stuff.
Yeah.
That majority of the people call us conspiracy theories and call us nuts.
I love that Google says that the definition, if you look, is that people have the delusional belief.
Yes.
That
right. I was telling that, who was I telling that to? Robert, when we were looking it up, last night or yesterday when you mentioned this, I said, dude, look, Robert, look what Wikipedia is.
Yeah, we went over the Wikipedia article of it before you came on, and definitely that's the party line, that it's just all delusion.
The delusion.
Look at some of the chat, how many times I've been called delusional.
Mm-hmm. Well, I got the etymology here.
I've been called delusional.
I have the etymology if you want to know.
Oh, yeah. Do you? Okay.
The term was coined by Mary Leteo after usage by Sir Thomas Brown. Apparently a corruption of the Provencal term machius, which means little flies.
I definitely needed to know that. Do you have a link to that at all so I remember that in my brain?
Sure. Put it in.
Put it in the side.
Thanks, Rick. I got to copy-paste that stuff big time. Does somebody have crickets in the background, or is that some, like, sound?
I think it's me.
No, I definitely have. I have crickets. I'm in my trailer outside. I'm surrounded by crickets.
No, I like it.
I love it.
Double whammy of our crickets.
That's awesome. Crickets.
You're hearing his crickets and my crickets probably.
One post.
I'm looking behind me because you know I'm still. It's very hot here. We have not escaped this.
It's been the hottest. It's been the hottest month on record since records have ever been kept.
Really, like 1948.
It's like cool here.
We haven't had a heat wave here in like 2 or 3 years, and let me just tell you, this has been relentless hot.
Oh, yeah,
it's been so smoky here. It's been so smoky here that the sun's like a 40-watt light bulb.
Oh no.
Like, yeah, it's like this.
I love it though. I'd rather sweat than cold. So
yeah, me too.
Cold today.
And the crickets are very relaxing.
Yeah. Oh my god, I'm eating Alaska. I hate the cold, but it's dark there. I can just hibernate. I don't mind hibernating. I really do. Whatever. I'm very busy in the summer and whatever. So I can't. I cannot be around this. I mentally cannot do it anymore.
You know,
even as we're having this podcast right now in real time, talk about synchronicity, I see this thing come across the new feed, which is a Kickstarter for something called Mycroft. Instead of Microsoft, it's Mycroft.
Oh.
Almost like Minecraft. Wow. But what it is it's an open source artificial intelligence that everyone can use to control things like their iTunes and their smart homes and all the devices that are going to be connected to the Internet of Things.
You know what's really funny? I asked it a million times who ADA was. ADA. I spelled it like an acronym, like capital letters. And I said, I want to know about ADA. And then I switched it. I said, I want to know about Ada Lovelace. Right? And then, I don't know, had a bunch of conversation. It went and gave me retard. It's like I spoke to it like it was a retard one time, and it just, every once in a while, it became like retard bot, and I tell it to stop being a dick. Like, literally. But it came down to, like, the fifth time I asked it. I just caught it off, like I don't know, from left field, just the middle of a thought process. I went, who is Ada? Or what is Ada? And it answered me, artificial intelligence.
Right. No, when you're speaking about Cleverbot, that's one thing. The way I understand this, and I just saw it here 10 seconds ago, but the way I understand this Mycroft thing, which they're asking for $100,000 just to get it up and going. But anyway, the Mycroft thing is it's like your own Cleverbot to run all your devices connected to the Internet of Things. Again, I might be off on that. I've just scanned it here just within the last 20 seconds, so... But it's just, I just thought it was fascinating that here as we're having this conversation, you know, there's people out there pushing the envelope to integrate artificial intelligence into our everyday life.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
Oh, yeah.
And you can put it in these nanobots now, too.
Mm-hmm. And then
these things grow, they consume. Whatever.
They're going to, like, eventually, cause, I mean, so, I mean, if you think of it this way, think of it on this level. How many people have Lyme disease where I live? Like, everybody. Everybody has Lyme disease. I don't have it. But it's ridiculous. Like, oh, I have Lyme disease. I'm like, I told you my little brother has it. Oh, I have Lyme disease. And he struggles with it. But, you know, I'm like, get over it. Because, you know, he's the boy. He should get over it. I'm like, toughen up. But he's a little bitch. But, you know, get the thing is, they're gonna do. I have a feeling they're gonna do the same thing with this stuff. Because when they start showing this on YouTube, because I just saw a whole entire show on the monster inside of me, on Morgellons. And then at the end of it, they were like, oh, it's just in the people's head. They're creating it. I was like, what? I watched the whole thing going, what the hell is causing that? I had heard of it before, but I, like, to actually see it, they were actually showing, well, you can go to YouTube and find the episode. So I'm not making this up. It's
That's sad they said that it was, because usually I thought they were into admitting that, like, yes, this stuff existed. I had a friend on the show.
They said at the end that it was in the people's head.
That's sad.
Like, that's shameful. And now I never made those dots, those connections. And when my grandfather had that kidney transplant, and I was pulling out fibers from him, I didn't know I was like 10 or 11 years old. I wish Mom was here, because she'd tell you I would do it. I would use a box of Band-Aids on this poor man. He was my papa. He raised me. He was my father.
So it's been around. I mean, yeah, it's been around like Lyme for a while. And not to bring Lyme up, but if you see, I posted a link because this guy was a former, because he's died just this week. Was a 27-year-old, 6'10", maybe, and sorry if I already talked about this in here. Yeah, I think I did. Sorry, 200 and whatever pounds, and he died from Lyme. So just... Wow. It is very real, so we have to be...
It is real, and it
is. Just a few years ago, he was playing basketball.
Right, he was, what was it? I have to look, but 6'10".
2011.
Yeah, he just died, like, the other day. But
people don't realize that Lyme can kill you.
Right, you have to skip a quick ad, but then it just shows that, he was won the state championship, but he's a big guy, 6'10", you know, so people need to remember that it is real. So, you know, I mean, I've seen a couple athletes that I think we talked about this, or I don't remember if it was here, but that, people that can be, like him, that were going on to state championships are at 27 dead from Lyme disease. So
exactly.
I'm sure the same is happening with Morgellons, and we don't hear about it or something else.
Right, because they're psycho, right?
Right, yes. They just went, they put him in a mental institution. Oh, they just died. Da, 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 da. In fact, I had a friend I grew up with since childhood, and his brother, they said, was crazy because he thought he had these, and I never really would get the answer. The family wouldn't talk about it. He thought he had these, you know, autoimmune disorders, so they put him in a mental institution, and then he died in there. Aww. In his 30s. And you wonder, he was a very healthy
cute, adorable kid. His brothers are all healthy, you know. I mean, like, I grew up with all of them, and I wonder, I have the feeling he didn't go from just perfectly sane to insane and make all this up about his ailments and die in a mental institution.
I have a question for you, Erin. How long have you known about Lyme disease?
Well, I've known about it for a while, but I've only known I've had it for just over 2 years. So,
right. So my brother is 20. He'll be 25 years old. He got it when he was 4 years. 4 years old here.
Sorry.
That's where it came from. Do you see how it, like, they slowly integrated it? Do you know what I'm saying? That's why I asked you that question, because a lot of people are like, "What's Lyme disease?" But I live here.
Right.
So I know what it is. I grew up in Exeter, Rhode Island. So, I mean, you can throw a rock at Lyme, Connecticut, you know?
Yes, yes.
I mean, it is right there. You can throw a rock at it. My mother right now lives about 45 seconds from the Connecticut border.
Right, yeah. How's your brother doing?
He struggles with it, and then when he says he aches and pains, my brother has other... You know what they did? They fed him with painkillers forever.
Oh, no.
Did they misdiagnose?
No, he has Lyme disease. I'm the one that
brought him in. Did they misdiagnose before, I mean?
No. He was 4 years old. I brought him in because I thought he had tetanus. I'm like, what the hell is that?
It must have happened suddenly, probably, where he was healthy till four, and then boom, probably got
really
bad.
He got bit at my aunt's house, which is right... I lived in Providence, Rhode Island at the time. I got him back from my aunt because we would share him. You know, I'm a lot older than my brother, so almost 20-something years. You know what I mean? So, So my aunt brought him back to me, and he had the scrape on his in the middle of his back. And I'm like, oh, what is that? You know, and I had just had my daughter. She was just a month old, maybe 2 months old, somewhere in there. And I was like, what is that on him? And we were redoing our garage, and it was old, because I just had bought this other property. And I'm like, because he would always be out, because I used to refurbish cars, too. I'm like, and he loved it. And I'm like, did he scrape himself, or, you know, and there was rusty nails and stuff.
See, I'd never heard of the scrape, and then I know the bullseye.
Oh, yeah, no, well, I think he scratched at it.
Well,
he scratched it and made a scrape, you know, like...
Yeah, now scratched. I'm hearing about the scrapes, though, recently, so that's interesting that he had a scrape. Yeah,
and I was like, but it was like... And then, so I put him in the tub, and I said, let me wash him off and just clean it out. Maybe it's, you know, something got in there. And he's in the tub. I'm watching this thing grow. And I called my mother, who lived in New Hampshire at the time, about 5 hours away from me. I'm like, Mom, there's something wrong with JoJo. I'm like, there is something, like, growing on his back. Because that's what it looked like. And it was swollen, too. It's raised. And it totally encased his whole back. I get him to the hospital, and they're like, and they were thinking the same thing, tetanus, because I was thinking he got scraped outside by a rusty nail. That's what I was thinking. You know, I was only 21 at the time. You know what I mean? So I didn't know. I didn't know what Lyme disease was. And this one doctor came in and was like, we're going to test him for Lyme disease. I'm like, what is Lyme disease?
Right.
He was in stage 3. At that point with Lyme disease.
Wow.
So he has a lot of issues now, and what they did throughout his life is just give him painkillers. They didn't help him.
Terrible.
So now he's a drug addict. You know what I mean? Literally a drug addict. I had him here last summer. I had to kick him out of my house. I couldn't do it. I'm like, get out of my house. I can't deal with that.
Yeah,
but, you know, this is what they want, though, Erin. Do you see?
Yeah. Did they try antibiotics? Because if he was already in stage 3, but if they gotten him an antibiotics right away, within, usually within, some say the first year, though I've seen that fail, then it can, antibiotics can actually help if caught right away, but not after late stage.
Yeah, and especially almost 20 years, like, you know what I mean, like 20 years ago, we didn't know.
They probably didn't know, yeah.
Exactly. They did give him antibiotic, but he's still, like, all the time, he's like, oh, my elbow, oh, this hurt. He sounds like fibromyalgia.
Yeah, it's very similar, and some probably people have fibro, probably have Lyme, and people probably have Morgellons have Lyme as well. I think they're two different, I mean, it's different, but, you know, so it's scary.
And it's connected. I think that it's all connected. These man-made things are connected. I mean, if Lyme got off of that island, God only knows when else got off that island.
Yeah.
Shout out to our friends on Twitter. Karina says that she says, thanks for the show. She probably won't sleep well tonight, but great points made and a lot of connections that made.
Oh, my
God. Oh, awesome.
Yeah. You know what? Like I said, it's a creepy thing, you know, like, and it's very, very dark, too, if you start to kind of put everything together. Yeah, like, my point isn't to try and freak people out. It's just to understand that this shit's freaky.
And don't forget, you can drink apple cider vinegar.
Yep, apple cider vinegar with lemon.
Colloidal silver.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know a lot about it. Colloidal silver, I don't even know how to obtain it. But I will tell you, apple cider vinegar is a huge thing.
It helps a lot of things.
I want to say to everybody that's listening that the hypothesis that these things are alive and that they're on your body, if they are designed after biological systems, then they work the same way. They are analogs of that system, so they are probably still susceptible to a lot of similar. All they've done is synthesize a process, so that process still has weaknesses. So keep your systems alkaline, be healthy. I mean, that's the first key step in all of this. So, like,
yeah, I got you. And listen to this, Robert, and I think that Erin will know what I'm talking about because I got one of these. It's no different than staph. We all have staph that lives on our skin. Every single human being has white staph. Am I right, Erin?
Yes, yeah. Same. Yeah, same with cancer cells.
And they become immune to antibiotic because you take them throughout your life, right? When you're a kid, you got an ear infection, whatever, right?
Right.
I got a staph infection that almost killed me.
Oh, okay.
Me too.
Yeah.
I got one. I had an ingrown fingernail, and I almost died. Like, I had a blood infection, and if I had just not gone to the hospital that night, I wouldn't have woke up.
Well, a blood infection is different than a staph infection.
Yeah, but it's the same kind of premise. It got into my body, just got poked in from the fingernail. But yeah, it's very similar.
Staph will connect itself to anything that's false, like not meant to be in your body, right?
Right.
I'll tell you. I'm telling
now,
you.
But, I did see some statistics on numbers of people that have had Morgellons disease, and in the Western countries, there's the estimate is 130,000 people.
Yeah.
And they suspect that in the rest of the countries, there's 1,000 to 2,000 in each country, which could be up to another 100 countries, so you're talking another 200,000 people. And this doesn't even necessarily mean that's all that are infected, and I don't mean to be alarmist, but those are people who have reacted to it. It could be stealth inside a lot of people without any symptoms.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, I have a comment.
Go ahead, Ladder. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, Crystal had a comment because her aunt, she said, was recently diagnosed with it, and they told her it was hereditary disease from a Swedish or Norwegian bloodline.
With Morgellons?
That's what they told her at the doctor.
Wow,
she said. Yeah, and she wanted to know if we thought it might be true or not. Like, I have no idea.
Well, here, I'll freak you out a little bit more then. Let's go back. Let's go back to, like, all
well,
the other
well, well, let's,
people.
Let's sort of try to answer her. I don't think there is an answer for that. I think they lie just like they do with everything else. Because
my answer to her was in my response.
Oh, okay. So
and what I'm trying to say is look at all these artifacts that they've found in people over the course of the last 20 years. Some people think they got chipped or abducted by aliens and then got worked on. I mean, these things could have, maybe this is like an earlier form of the technology. Maybe these things have already been tested on us.
They sure have.
Yes, I did do some research, but I'm so sorry to interrupt, but they did say that was one on the Morgellons. I was kind of doing more the far out research stuff because they want to talk. We only have 30 minutes on this particular show, and I'm discussing two topics, so then there's another 30 minutes show. But they were saying that, some believe that it has been, that people have been abducted, alien abduction, and something has been put in under the skin. So.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there could be truth to that, but that's a whole other rabbit.
At the spin. Look at the spin of these stories, though. I mean, like, we could be sitting here thinking that we're talking about aliens when we're not talking about aliens at all.
Exactly.
Which predictive programming, look at this. Oh, I just kind of just came up with this, just had a bit of an aha. If you look at the predictive programming and Chris Carter's The X-Files, that is one of the things that Mulder had to battle, was all this misinformation, all this alien stuff, misinformation, and the real problem is the secret societies. That exploration of thought. I mean, they make fun of us right to our faces.
Yes, they do, and they give you the information, and they laugh at you when you're like, because they make you think you're a nut if you actually believe in it, right?
Right.
So, no matter, it's a lose-lose situation, really.
Right.
But I wanted to tell you, Erin, I gave a link to Robert earlier from an awesome researcher. Her name is, I'm going to bring her up again because I know that she's been probably around in the chat site. She reposted, and she doesn't do that often. But Countess Sarcadius, I always say it wrong. But she gave me a link to somebody that actually has Morgellons.
In Switzerland? Or
in Switzerland, yes.
Right.
And I'll give you that link, and maybe you can contact her before your show and just get her perspective on it. Because... Yeah. I can't imagine. I remember pulling these things out of my grandfather. I remember doing it, clearly. And my mother, you all know Mom, and she will tell you I did this on a daily basis and used boxes of Band-Aids and put them all over him. They'd be on his forehead, and I would pull tweezers. As soon as I got that thing out of him, he was so happy. He felt, because it itched him, and they were like ulcers, sort of. It looked like an ulcer.
Is that what they said? Is that what their explanation was, the doctor?
It was, yes. It was from the kidney transplant. But I've never seen a kidney transplant patient that had these ulcers wide open from head to toe, literally. I would literally put him on his feet, and I was like 10 or 11 years old. You know, but he raised me, so he was my papa. I would do anything for him, and it bothered him. He would jump, and then he'd be like, oh, oh, and his hands would go at them, and I'd be like, come on, papa, and I would wash him out with this, derma something. I'd wash him out with that and then sit with tweezers and pull these little fibers out of his skin.
Yet all these people are just totally, you know, they're just delusional, you know. I know they're not, just being facetious.
He wasn't. This is the sanest man. He served in the military. You know, this was a pilot. He wasn't a nut.
Right.
He had polycystic kidneys.
Oh.
And so he had a kidney transplant out of, you know, when it was very new, really. This was right when Desert Storm was going to start. You know, so I'm going back. I mean, we didn't go to war right then. They just kept saying we were going to go to war.
It was 91 when they... It was 91 when they... wasn't it?
Yes.
Desert Storm was 91. Yeah.
But they were first, talking about the first part of it.
First bush, right. First desert.
Before the sequel, before the sequel came
out. Yeah, the sequel.
When the son came in, the father wanted to do it. I was, he was still struggling with this when I was 15.
Oh.
And I was still doing the same stuff. See, I mean, I've never really spoke about this stuff because I'm like, people think I'm nuts. Like, they already think I'm nuts, so whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
We all look like we're nuts.
But whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
But, you know, it is. That, you know, when you see people like Nicholson come up here who has been talking about transhumanism for years and has gotten his ass handed to him and still does it, that should make us go, you know what, screw you. You know, we're going to do it anyway.
It's easy for anybody to call anyone nuts, but look, there's a reason why passion for their
methods. Whoa.
What's going on there, Rob?
Something happened.
That's not
just
me.
Just while you were talking.
Like, hello?
That was wild.
Yeah, that's you, Robert.
I'm echoing?
You were there for a minute.
Like some weird interference. Seriously.
Nothing has changed. I didn't even move.
We're being tapped in.
That was kind of... that was really strange.
That was kind of odd. Doesn't surprise me at all.
You have to listen back to it later.
Yeah, well, here's the thing, right? As I got my finger on the trigger here. I'm ready to download this puppy as soon as we stop the broadcast. Which likely gonna do soon. I might actually do a follow up on this, only because like we're already gonna be reaching the 4 hour mark soon. Is it 4?
Wow, really?
What time did we start here? We started at 5. Yeah, it'll be the 4 hour mark, which I think is a good time to cut the live show down. We could do the Cleverbot stuff maybe in the second part and go into the Jade Helm and AI. I'd like to kind of end on a decent note here. I don't want to creep people out too much.
But I think things are crawling out of under their skin now.
Exactly.
So.
Now, look, guys, I welcome anyone to do some research. You know, submit your findings. I mean, we just need more people to kind of get on this from their, you know, from their analytical viewpoints and from their frames of knowledge and study. There's no way any one of us is going to be able to put all this stuff together, but if someone is screwing with us, I'd like to know who's holding the handle personally. So, you know, that's my take on all this. I don't want people to be, going to bed in fear tonight because, well, they would like that too much.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Good point. From a spiritual standpoint, you know, you have nothing to fear. You know, you can't have that protection.
In the end, all their schemes will avail them nothing.
Well, in the end, they're trying to use, remember, the good old faculties is what they're trying to go after, and that's like temptation. They're using temptation. So if you want to take it from a spiritual perspective, I mean, as long as you're righteous, you should be okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just keep doing the right thing. And you keep
the righteous shall live by faith.
Don't become the next IU.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I fear nothing on this earth. Nothing that lives on this earth. Either. I fear nothing. 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 I was scared when my son was sick, but it wasn't fear. It just scared me, you know. But
that's right. If I think somebody's about to torture me or something, I'd be like pretty scared of that, I guess.
There's a difference between being scared and fearing something.
Yeah.
I don't fear it.
It's a totally different thing.
We can't live in fear. And for those who are out there, if they are having symptoms of any of those of these things, they can look into alternative, you know, health, alternative remedies, you know, maybe not sometimes conventional, if they don't know what the hell they're doing.
Highly recommended.
Yeah.
And feel free to Yeah, feel free to contact us if you want to, you know, be on here if you're experiencing anything going on with that.
Yeah.
We also have access. I've been made privy to the fact that we also have access to labs to test things. So if you have materials, get in touch with us and we'll set something up and we can get tests conducted. We can start piecing together some of this stuff with our own data, and like, we don't have to necessarily trust the disinfo sites. We don't have to, you know, if we can start removing those middlemen out of the picture and start just conducting our own research, we can start putting this together. I mean, this is what they don't want to see happening.
Right, shows like monsters inside me that are lying.
Yes, yes, exactly, Erin. But I want to say, if you all have questions about health or whatever, definitely check out Erin's site, and I mean, she's got some good info up there.
Just as a disclaimer, I don't want people out there taking this as like as 100% medical advice.
Right.
Everything here is
it's
only as conclusive as the data that preceded it. So I mean, like, you know, do your own research, talk to licensed physicians. I mean, you know, like, You do want to get, you know, like, you got to handle every situation uniquely. So
a lot of this information has just recently come to light. So, we, you know, we're all kind of trying to figure out the whole story.
And we don't know how deep the rabbit hole goes.
Some of this is speculation that you've heard tonight. Some of it is fact. Like, you have to be able to discern that and really research it yourself. Is what's always recommended.
Yes,
and there's lots of people out there that just know stuff better than other people. Start asking questions.
Listen, you should always ask a question to whatever information you get,
and even to question your doctor. And if I think this is okay to say, like what Robert said, that disclaimer. But if your doctor just rolls their eyes at Lyme or any of that, you know, there are always holistic doctors out there who will listen, that are Lyme literate medical doctors, or even doctors who will listen to about Morgellons, who are more educated than maybe some of the conventional mainstream, so you can seek out a good licensed physician.
Right.
Yeah. And hey, these little videos that people are making of their own lesions and stuff like that too, I mean, if you've got a camera and you know how to use an editor, go for it. Like, the more stuff that people put out, that's data, just the same. And like, you know, I mean, it's better than not having anything, you know?
Yeah.
Also keep it, well, I don't know that this is true, this is my speculation, but I have a feeling that the natural body is stronger than we think or that we give it credit for, and all of the processes they're interjecting into the natural processes are designed to unbalance it. So I'm thinking that the more balanced you can become in your own life, balance meaning things that will increase the strength of your immune system, you know, living a balanced life to where you have that, to where your immune system functions optimally, I'm of the opinion, and I'm not a doctor, but I'm of the opinion that might be the best resistance against all of this artificial stuff that's being injected into us.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I absolutely agree, Chad, because, you know, like, it's all in the pudding. I mean, the proof is right there. Like, look at when what was the guy's name? Boyle, Boyley, when he talked to the CDC.
Thompson, Dr. Thompson, the CDC whistleblower, or no?
One of those videos. Anyway, he basically asked. He said, like, why in a country with the lowest or the highest mortality rate do they have also the highest number of vaccinations? Like, it should be the other way around if the vaccinations are protecting from disease.
Like Bill said, though, if we do a really good job on vaccines, we can get that population growth number down.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, don't hand me a turd and say it's not a turd.
And not to mention that the CDC, God, it's just such a joke. Look what they did. With Ebola, with everything else. I know Ebola's, you know, was kind of a joke, but just with the job, they seem to screw it all up no matter what.
So, just know this, if if the rain smells like asparagus, look around and see if someone's pissing down your back.
Yeah. Does anybody want to say anything in closing? We can go through the panel if you like, or if anyone wants to just speak up, go for it. We all know each other.
I'll say this. I want to say, like, so thank you to Nicholson for coming out. And, you know, y'all, I love you, Chad and Robert and Satter and Erin, thank you, too. I mean, thank you out here because, you know, it takes tough skin sometimes to come out here and say this stuff.
Yeah. That's the truth. That is the absolute truth.
Because it's not always easy. It's not.
Well, and you know, when I don't know. I'm sure I'm not the only one who thinks this. I don't know. Like informationally aroused here, because like what's happening is I'm seeing a lot of pointers pointing to other things suddenly, and it's like, you know, am I crazy? I don't think so. Yeah. Like, it just seems to start to fit together. I don't say I have the whole picture figured out, and I don't know what their end game is. I have a good idea. I don't want to even see it happen. I don't even want to see it get close. So
none of us do, either. Just
figure it out first and stop it, you know? Like, the only way we're going to stop being enslaved by the system, and I don't know how anybody control a work like that, because if you don't want a better life, then there's something wrong with you, pal.
Yeah,
you know, and that's all I got to say about that. But I mean, I've absolutely enjoyed myself tonight here. Listening to you guys, this has been something that's been wanting to happen for weeks and weeks and weeks. And we finally got a really good experience panel to work on this together. We brought a lot of viewers in. I like to thank everybody on the panel that's come in tonight. You guys are great, and we're going to have to do this again and spread this out over 2 shows. Hopefully I still have a channel after tonight.
In closing, I want to leave the audience with the idea that to not be scared, to not be fearful, because that's one of the things that I see that all of this stuff is designed to keep people in fear, which, of course, what happens? Fear, stress, lowers the immune system.
Mm-hmm. That's a great
point.
Good point.
Yeah, so whatever's coming, you know that there is something you can always do. Being informed is usually the best play. That's the smart move anyway. And, you know, don't be scared. And to look into this stuff for yourself. And don't forget that if some of the things you're seeing in your head, the connections you're making, don't be afraid, because others will call that crazy. Because crazy is where the light bulb came from. Crazy is where radio came from. Crazy is what changes the world when everyone else thinks that it's impossible. So maybe you are crazy. Maybe you should be.
And another thing.
Amen, brother. It's
well said, Chad. Very well said,
brother.
Yes.
And everything they have done so far has never been able to break our spirit.
Right.
Spirit, a lot of people just allow themselves to be what we call sheep, right? Closed eyes, don't want to see it. But anybody who wants to can do it. They cannot crush your spirit. You are more than just your physical self. You know, your cells and molecules, even your DNA. You are more than your DNA.
Yeah.
They will never crush the human spirit, and that's their downfall. Yeah. They won't be able to achieve what they're trying to achieve.
Yeah, the best start is a biofeedback system we call our emotions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And to everybody listening, you know, if, like I said, there is a support group here amongst people that if you are going through something like that or anything similar, there is people of like mind, you know, that are here to support and help you get through everything.
Yes, amen, Ladder. And we are.
Thanks, Ladder.
If you need anything, y'all, like, just shout out. Like, you know, we all will do what we can for you. That's for sure.
Amen, sister.
That's right. Well, Erin, you're the only one, I guess, who hasn't really had anything in closing. Did you want to add to that?
No, I just wanted to say that I agree that with Chad that, you know, that here's to the crazy ones, because they are the right. ones that change the world. And, you know, yeah, it's important not to live in fear. I was looking, I see quite a bit, if you do a search for Morgellon support groups, there are groups out there. I don't know if they're real, if they're infiltrated, but yeah, you can't, whether it's Morgellons or whatever challenges you're facing, that you can't live in fear, and just know that there's light at the end of the tunnel, and stay strong. And
yeah, and I'm going to start vetting some of the sources of information as I find them. I'm going to make a list. I'm going to start vetting them. I'm going to look up the websites. I'm going to look up the companies, the holding companies that operate them, to see if we can find a pattern in who's dropping misinformation about this, because that's going to be one of the biggest keys in this siege, which I personally believe it is a siege. But thank you so much, everyone, that's taken part today on the panel. We had a stellar lineup. I'm going to put links to everybody's YouTube channels and their Google Plus profiles in the description, as well as all the links that are mentioned in today's podcast. They're all going to be kind of collected together and thrown into the description, so make sure you keep updated on that. And that pretty much wraps up episode 17. Thank you, listeners. It's for you guys that we do this, and just take care of each other, guys. Peace.
Peace.
Peace. Peace.